Hello and welcome to a new episode of the Game Informer Show. I'm your host, Ben Hansen, joined by Ben Reeves.
How's it going?
Real good. Wonderful to see you. Suriel Vasquez.
Hello.
And Joe Juba.
Yeah!
Yeah, we're here to have some fun, by gunnet. We have a hell of a show. Do you remember, it feels like a lifetime ago, when Andy McNamara hosted like two episodes of the podcast back to back?
Oh, that was great.
That was, what a wonderful time.
Oh my gosh, best.
Not many people picked up on it. I would argue nobody picked up on it. Normally, when you go out on a cover story trip, it's like 1 week, roughly, right? The fact that he did 2 weeks, why is that? That's because we were in Japan for 2 weeks, because we're doing two Capcom covers back-to-back. We did Monster Hunter World, and now we're happy to reveal that our new cover story, Reeves, is...
Mega Man 11!
There we go, Mega Man 11. So Ben Reeves and I were out in Osaka at Capcom's headquarters, which was a pretty unique experience. Spent 2 days playing Mega Man 11, talking to the developers.
Eating crispy chicken.
Oh my gosh, so much delicious crispy chicken. Yeah. So we're going to go into a lot of details about Mega Man 11, the process of bringing that game to life. We might have a special guest later on who can say...
How much crispy chicken detail are you going into?
It probably won't come up.
It's embargoed. We can talk about it.
Then after that, we're talking about Destiny 2 Curse of Osiris.
That's right.
Surreal, we've talked about it before, but now we can really rip off that Band-Aid.
That's right. We can talk about whatever we want.
Oh, my God. We're going to get into all of it. We're going to get Miller
in here. It'll mostly be about the expansion. But
yeah, it should be a fun time. Then community emails. Then back half of the show. It came in hot, but it's a fun chat. We have two developers from Phoenix Labs who are making Dauntless. Do you guys know what Dauntless is?
Spaceships?
Nope.
It's not the spaceship game?
It is the indie sort of like, sort of between indie and AAA sort of Monster Hunter game.
That's exactly it, Suriel. Well done. There's not a spaceship in sight. So we have Ian Tornay and Nick Clifford from Phoenix Labs in here, actually in the studio, so the audio quality is nice, talking about the process of making, of founding Phoenix Labs and making this game that is, you know, probably doing it a disservice, but easily summarized as like, oh, a Western indie take on Monster Hunter, but I think indie is also, it looks good. You should check out footage online.
The developers also have some pedigree, right? Like they split off from major studios.
That's it. A lot of them came directly from Riot, but they have experience from Capcom, from Blizzard, and a lot of people that worked at EA.
Oh.
And so we talked
on spaceship games?
Oh, a lot of spaceship games. Maybe that's what you were thinking.
Yeah, that's totally, that's where I was confused.
I totally understand. So they talk about a big update that they have coming up for the game. Talk about just the process of what it's like for a new startup team to tackle a game as ambitious as, like let's make a game kind of like Monster Hunter.
Yeah.
Leo's in the booth, and he's really into the conversation we had about servers, because when they launched the game, the server demand wasn't, you know, keeping up. And so it's that process of, what do you do? What does it mean when servers are down? Why can't game companies get this right? We talk about that.
Hmm.
And maybe the peak of the conversation is they both worked on the community and marketing end of the Mass Effect trilogy.
Okay.
And they have a wonderful story about the absurd moment when EA decided to launch copies of Mass Effect 3 into outer space for the game's launch. Do you remember this, Joe?
Vaguely, yeah.
Yeah, it was a weird PR stunt that went terribly awry. So it's a very fun, long story about what the hell was going on there. So if you like Mass Effect, you want to learn more about Dauntless, stay tuned for that.
That's just next level, like PR shenanigans, right? Like,
yes.
Like there are tons of, you can rent helicopters and do all kinds of stuff, but when it comes to like I just can't imagine the money and coordination required to try and shoot something into space.
Yeah, it seems like it could go wrong in a bunch of different ways, and maybe it did. Huh. Stay tuned to the back half of the show.
When the aliens come, Mass Effect 3 will be the only thing they find.
They were also very disappointed in the ending.
Oh, it's going to be the unpatched ending too, so they're going to be pissed.
Oh, man. God, that Buzz Aldrin voice acting. Ben Reeves, you are the only person at this table, the only person outside of Capcom, as far as we know, that's ever played Mega Man 11.
That's right. With these thumbs.
Those thumbs.
I played them.
What did you think of Mega Man 11 in general? What was the big takeaway after that trip?
I liked it.
It's
a good game. It feels a lot like Mega Man of yore, let's say, the old classic Mega Man. It's a new look, obviously. If you've been online, you've probably seen the screens. It's fun, and especially, like, it's been 7 years since we've had a new Mega Man game.
Yeah.
And even longer than that, since we've had, like, a new Mega Man game that kind of, like, takes the art in a new direction, takes the art forward. It's really been since, like, the PlayStation.
That's interesting to think about.
Which
is interesting to think about.
So it's been a long time since we've had a Mega Man game that looks new.
Yeah.
And I think this one looks good in motion. Like, it's...
There's some people
who debated it against our screens, right?
I spent an uncomfortable amount of time on that trip thinking about, like, oh, with Capcom, some of their fighting games lately, you know, Street Fighter V had some debate, MVCI had some debate. And so I spent so much of that trip just staring at the screen while you were playing, thinking, like,
this
our fans, yeah, are fans going to be pissed about this art style? Like, it seems fine to me.
Yeah.
And I think in stills, maybe it doesn't come across as well, but seeing it in motion, it seems like it's convinced more people. And by and large, people are okay with it, as far as I can tell.
I think it looks good. I think it's hard because you compare it to something like Dragon Ball Z, which is a recent game that we just had on our cover, which is an amazing looking game. That
one
looks
of the best
like,
looking games ever. Yeah. Like, you can't top it.
It looks exactly like an animated show, which is cool, and I wish they'd maybe pushed in that direction. But for what it is, it looks great. And they commented too on just like when you up the visuals, it makes it harder to like make the controls feel tight. That was their
prioritizing animation. That's right. Is the big issue. Yeah.
If animation's more involved, then making sure that the controls feel like a classic 8-bit Mega Man game is harder.
Well, how did it feel?
And it felt good. It felt like kind of like what I said, like an old school Mega Man game. It feels just as tight as at least I remembered. You did not play it, but it's also very hard.
Oh my God. This is another big takeaway. It was a very bizarre situation where it's like, all right, first person outside of Capcom to ever play Mega Man 11. We're handing you the controller, Ben Reeves. You're going to want to press B to get started there. And he's like, okay. And then repeatedly kept pressing the wrong button. It's a very stressful situation.
That's not, I was pressing the button they told me.
Okay.
There was a debug thing going on. I'm just saying, but you're painting me in a bad picture.
Yeah. No. But then Reeves did an amazing job, and he played through two stages, including like beating the Robot Masters at the end.
Right.
But it felt like a long, old school gaming session where it was myself and Reeves, Tim Turi, former Game Informer editor, working at Capcom, working on this game. He was there, other Capcom PR, and then also the two lead developers, like the producer and the director, all just watching Ben Reeves just beat his head against a wall trying to beat these two really hard stages.
It was one of the most intense moments I remember of a cover story I've been on, just because having the director and the producer right there watching you play, and if you die more than like twice on any sequence, you're like, oh gosh, am I going to do this? Am I going to be able to overcome this? And then hearing them talk in Japanese to like the the translator and not knowing what they're saying, and then
I spoke Japanese a little. I didn't tell you. They were saying, is something wrong with him? What's wrong with this oaf?
At some point you died and they just said,
cognitive problems, right?
Does he know which button shoots?
Yeah.
But then Tim was like, oh no, he's really good at games. He's always very like, he's committed, he'll overcome, because me and Tim played Donkey Kong Country Returns together, and like, that was a similar situation. That game is hard, and eventually we overcome. So Tim's talking about that while I'm trying to overcome this thing. I was like, I just need to beat this thing. And then I would beat it and be like, oh, thank you.
It was hard.
And it's important to note, too, like those, like Mega Man has that series has a reputation for just being, I mean, it's no like, what's the way to say it? Like,
no walk in the park.
You need, like, that is a trial and error sort of series.
Right.
You know, like in general, you're not supposed to like, select a level, get through the whole thing, and beat the Robot Master in one run. It's
14 minutes. All right, next game.
Let's go. Yeah, I mean, it takes. I remember having that experience when I was younger. I had Mega Man 2 like just straight up memorized, I picked that up again when the
Legacy Collection. Yeah.
Did they have one of those on the? I think that was on the NES Classic too, maybe.
Mega Man 2, I think so.
I think that's where I was playing it, because then I hopped in and just realized that, like, though I could still remember some of it, it was like there was definitely a relearning process that had to happen for that.
And this is not Mega Man, dude. This is all new. But if you're scared of like, oh, I don't want it to be too difficult, the interesting thing with Mega Man 11 is they actually have four difficulty options.
Right. And so we were playing on normal, which is the third difficulty.
What?
And they say that's like, yeah, it's kind of weird that they have two easy modes.
Well, they have newcomer, casual, normal, and superhero.
Yeah.
As the four.
But normal is like a traditional Mega Man game, which is, I would say, harder than most normal games today, let's say.
Oh, yeah.
And then superhero mode is even going to be harder. So if you want a challenge, you're going to have a challenge. But then if you want an easier time, we didn't get to play the two easy modes, but they're presumably a lot easier. They did say that they'll add new platforms, like shorter like checkpoints, stuff like that.
Yeah, they're gonna change easier. So like on normal, a level, a stage will have like 2 to 3 checkpoints. It said newcomer mode checkpoints numbers will bump up, and also like you'll get like support items to like alleviate knockback and like little things like that.
Yeah,
which will be nice.
Did Mega Man like 9 and 10 have those features?
I know 10 had it, but I'm not sure about
10 had a easy mode.
Yeah,
if I'm right. Didn't have, I think it just had the two though, right?
Yeah, I think it just had a thing. I know it. I remember hearing about a mode with extra platforms.
Yeah. And then Mega Man Powered Up also had that.
Oh, yeah. Powered Up was great.
All right, Joe, you're in charge of making Mega Man 11.
Yeah.
What do you do? You know, like, that's the task these developers had, and it is a tough one. Like, You could go a number of different directions. Which direction would you go, and would you want them to go?
Okay, well, so it's funny that Mega Man Powered Up just came up, because I think that that is probably like one of my favorite Mega Man games ever.
Oh, interesting.
I mean, like, there's a lot of nostalgia for me wrapped up in like Mega Man, you know, 1, 2, 3. Mm-hmm. But in terms of just like the play experience, I think what makes Powered Up and Maverick Hunter X interesting is that they add new wrinkles to just the basic, like, play a stage, fight the robot master formula.
Yeah.
Which I think that's kind of what, for Mega Man, kind of what led to its, not downfall isn't the right word, but sort of like fading over the years, probably. Yeah. Was like people just kind of know what to expect exactly from a Mega Man game. And I like those because like they change the formula a bit. So I guess what I'm saying, if I'm in charge,
yes,
I'm not saying make all these sort of like different playable characters. I don't know all the answers to it. But for me, I think it's find a way to change up that formula so it's like not as predictable, and to give players like surprising and interesting moments beyond just the like Mega Man 1, 2, 3 like template.
Totally. And I feel like with 9 and 10, they were as classic and retro as possible.
Exactly.
And yeah. So it's like, yeah. Even though it's been so long, I would imagine fans still want things to shake up. And Mega Man 11, we can't talk about a certain feature/mechanic in the game, but it does change things up more than any other feature mechanic throughout mainline Mega Man reuse.
It changes things up more than any other Mega Man game. And we did get to play with it, and I like it, and it was helpful.
Also,
it
it's completely optional. So if you want a classic experience, you can totally have that.
You could not have it. You could totally use it, and it's beneficial, and it changes the moment-to-moment gameplay. That's about all we can say about it. We'll obviously share more when they like release that embargo, but it's cool. But it's a cool new feature.
It does, I mean, beyond sort of like the new feature, it does have some stuff from later Mega Man games, right? You can slide.
Yes.
Yeah, you can slide. You can charge up your beam.
Okay.
One cool thing that is new is there's like a, I called it an invisible weapon wheel, if you know what I mean. Like, you have the right analog stick and you can switch the weapon you want with the analog stick. But there's no like, it's like Ratchet and Clank in that you can pick it, but there's no visible weapon wheel.
Okay.
Yeah. That makes sense. So it's like upper right would switch over to a certain Robot Master, down left would switch over to a different one.
So it's much quicker. Yeah, it's a good choice. And also just simple stuff like they emphasize, like, oh, it's not just a palette swap for Mega Man once he absorbs Robot Master's powers. Right. It actually is like a full transformation. You can see a good example in like that blue look, the different teal look, I guess, for Mega Man that's in our site and the cover story and overall online for the videos they've released, to kind of get a rough feel of what he could look like, and just imagine that times all the different Robot Masters.
Yeah, cool.
Just real quick stuff, like after you defeat a Robot Master, it goes to like this blueprint screen, and then you get a little tutorial on the new weapon and stuff, which is nice.
Yeah, so you can mess around with the weapon more than they've done that sometimes in the past, but like it feels like you have more opportunity to mess around with this and use it with the new mechanic and use it with by charging up your shot and like see what it does. Every weapon has a different effect when you charge it up.
So
this,
I guess,
is just the basic shot.
My question there is like, to what degree do you need a tutorial with Mega Man weapons? Because like previously it's just been like, you got this weapon. Whoop, whoop, whoop. And you see it. It's like, oh, that's what this weapon looks
like.
Fires
a saw blade.
Yeah. I mean, like, do they perform differently enough? Are they mechanically different enough to like need some time to like get comfortable with it?
I mean, it's just nice. It's the one that they did show off was with the like brick things that you can see in the trailer that appear from the sky and fall down. Like, that's a little bit different than just the thing that shoots out in front of you.
Yeah.
So that's the thing where you can like drop from the sky, and there isn't the other Robot Master weapon we played with functioned differently as well than a normal just shoot thing. So they're maybe a little bit different than normal. It's not like game changing, but it is nice to be like, there were times when I used those powers and it was way easier to get through certain sequences in a level using that power. And it's like, they thought through like, how are players going to use these weapons in the stages? And how might that make your job easier as a player?
So some of them can function as more than just different kinds of ammo.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay.
Yeah, at least out of the two we saw, definitely.
So I was always afraid in some of those earlier Mega Man games to ever use any of my special weapons because like I'd never know what I'd need for the boss fight once I got there.
Yeah, and that's how I've always played too. I don't know. It might be one of those things where maybe you have to let that go a little bit because it is very much in your benefit to use those Robot Masters outside of Robot Master battles.
Yeah.
And I don't know. That's just like reprogramming your brain a little bit. But yeah, I would say mess around with it because it's fun.
But it's the same general mechanic as before, where it's like if you use it in the level, you have like an energy bar that depletes, and as you kill enemies, they drop stuff that maybe fills it up a little. It's that same sort of approach.
Yeah, exactly.
Cool.
And there are E-tanks, so I assume there might be tanks for your weapons as well. They didn't explicitly say that, but that's kind of an assumption on my part.
Yeah, yeah. And with the Robot Masters in general, they said they wanted to kind of take it back because it's like, oh, the first couple Mega Man games, like it was pretty easy to figure out the kind of rock, paper, scissors layout of like, okay, I bet this weapon's strong against this.
Mm-hmm.
And then in a video interview we put up yesterday, they talked about like how eventually the series just got so weird where it's like Centaur Man versus Night Man, like what defeats what? And so expect Mega Man 11 to kind of not repeat Robot Masters, but kind of go back to the roots, a little more primal, some would say elemental aspect of like, okay, clearly I can understand this, and then this, then this, then this.
Oh, interesting. Yeah. Okay.
Rockman will beat Paper Man.
Yeah.
It's the other way around.
What did you think about just the game's development, Reeves? What did you learn after spending so much time with those developers?
Yeah, good question. It was interesting to get some insight into like what was the vibe in the studio after Inafune left.
Yeah, they're surprisingly like open. It was nice. Yeah. I mean, it would be so easy for a studio to kind of talk around even saying Inafune, but they're like, yeah, it's Inafune left. He had a lot of great ideas, and then it was just this weird vacancy, and it was kind of sad that we weren't doing anything with Mega Man.
Yeah, and they were open to saying, like, you know, there were a couple of times we experimented with what can we do next with Mega Man. None of those projects really worked out, but this is the one that did work out, so we feel confident in this one.
Which
is kind of fun. It makes me want to know, like, okay, well, I'd love to see those tech demos of whatever the other Mega Man games that didn't work out were.
And it wasn't necessarily this team. Like, you never know. It seemed like it was, like, different people within the studio being like, I can make a new Mega Man, and then it gets a little ways, and like, not so much. Then eventually the team that ends up making it is an internal team within Capcom, as far as we can tell. And so the director, Oda, and producer, Tsuchiya, Tsuchiya has worked on Mega Man before on like 5 and 7. Oda has been at Capcom since 1991.
Wow. Yeah.
But he has never worked on Mega Man.
No.
And now he's the game director, and he's always said that he's had a lot of ideas about what he could do with the series, including what this new mechanic is. Right. And so he's excited to kind of
It's bugging me that you can't talk about that. I want to know what it is.
I know. I'm sorry. I wish I could as well, Joe.
Yeah. One interesting thing, like talking to Oda, he's like a huge horror fan. He worked on the Resident Evil series.
Director of Resident Evil Zero, stuff like that.
Yeah, yeah. And he like dropped casually in this conversation this like little tidbit that I was like, wait a minute, what? Like he was like, oh yeah, like back when we were working on the first Resident Evil, back when it was on the Super Nintendo, a little blah, blah, blah. I'm like, wait a minute, what? So I guess maybe it's out there and I didn't know, but I looked online and like nobody was talking about this. But
and it was a good
Resident
sign.
Evil was originally on the Super Nintendo, which is kind of crazy.
They were starting to build it there and it like took place in hell or a hellish place, as they put it. And it was still had like a working title, like horror game. But it was funny because he said that. And it's like, is this one of those well-known things that just I didn't know? And then I looked over at Tim and I saw Tim lean over and whisper to somebody from Capcom, I didn't know this. Like, oh, okay, if Tim didn't know, then clearly this is something new. But that's the glory and the beauty of like talking so much to somebody that's been working at Capcom, the same place since 1991. Right. I mean, like Ghouls and Ghosts level, it's just awesome to see
what,
like
26 years?
Yeah, old gray hair Japanese developer. Like that guy has seen so much crazy stuff we cannot even imagine.
They try to embargo it. Like you can't talk about the fact that Resident Evil was developed for this NES.
No, actually, we talked about making it the cover story.
Can we get those documents? Yeah, that would have been really cool. But he was cool to talk about. And just the fact that he's like huge horror nerd and, he developed the Strider game, the Strider reboot, like years back, if you remember that. But it's just like, he's been at Capcom for that long and he's never touched Mega Man. But he was so excited to like, I finally get to work on Mega Man. For him, it was like, you know, the pinnacle of his career or something like that. That's kind of what he said. He's like, I've been looking forward to this for a long time. It's like, I'm finally doing Mega Man. Like, it's interesting, like, inside the company that people have that much excitement or reverence for Mega Man. So.
And even, like, it's fun to hear people, because a lot of people within Capcom, they've released a lot of Mega Man games over the years, have never touched the mainline series. So stuff like the artist, I forget his name now, I'm very sorry, but it's his first time working on a proper Mega Man game. He worked on, like, Battle Network. He did, like, enemy designs for Mega Man Legends and stuff.
Yeah.
We have a video going up with him later on in the month. Or the composer has only worked on the Star Force series. It's like, all right, stepping up, time to make a proper Mega Man. And so that has to be exciting.
Yeah. My favorite part of the interview with the artist was we were talking to him about his designs, and then he pulls out these three sheets that look like super old, like sketches. Yeah. And he's like, oh, these are the three Mega Man bosses I submitted for the Mega Man boss battle entry like back in like 1994.
Oh yeah. I submitted tons of those too.
Oh, I bet so they were like, awesome, Joe. Like, oh, it's Homer Simpson, man.
Joe, man.
Yeah, I'd love to like, compare your drawings to his and see.
He He did come up with Batman, which I think is pretty original.
That's pretty good. Another one was Liquid Man, which I actually kind of like.
Yeah, they're in the cover story. If you
but then like we're there. Like, oh, this is awesome. What were you doing when you drew these? Like, oh, I was working at Capcom. Like, he's like, he was working at Capcom, but he secretly submitted these entries into the Mega Man Boss Challenge under like a pseudonym just because he wanted to see.
I had to submit my idea for Batman in secret. No one could know.
Hey, go ahead, Joe. So I know, I mean, well, a lot of developers are wary of sort of saying anything that could be misinterpreted or interpreted as sort of, you know, throwing shade at other developers, right?
Yeah.
Did anyone talk about Mighty No. 9 in any capacity while you guys were there?
The internet sure did when they announced Mega Man 11.
That's right.
I don't think the developers brought it up. They definitely said that they love the kind of renaissance that 2D platformers have had recently in their minds. Like, we love a good hard platform. We love playing stuff. Kind of like hinting towards Cuphead or something in that vein. But no, it did not come up.
Okay.
It's not like we have to make it wildly different from that game or anything like that, but I'm sure they think about it internally a fair amount.
Yeah, I mean, like you said, when this game is unveiled, when it's like, okay, 2D platformer, 3D style, art style in this, I mean, following a sort of familiar Mega Man formula, like, I think it's hard to not sort of draw that parallel. And I was sort of wondering if they had any sort of, like, mentioned any sort of strategy to say, like, look, we know people were disappointed with Mighty No. 9. We are trying to avoid that in these specific ways.
Not that directly, but certainly that sentiment and general vibe.
Yeah, they did talk a lot about, like, okay, do we take Mega Man in a new direction? Do we make it a 3D game? Do we, you know, one of the quotes is, like, do we put glasses on him? Which I thought was amusing. Like, that's what you're thinking
about.
I've
always wanted to put glasses on him.
Yeah.
But
since 1991, I've dreamed of lowering glasses on the Mega Man's dumb face.
But
he's been farsighted all this time, and he just gets no correction.
He keeps shooting his buddies. They're other robots, dude.
It's why it's 2D side-scrolls, because he can't see literally that far.
He has no depth perception. Yeah.
Four eyes, man. But they kept coming back to, like, you know, that Mega Man formula, the original formula just worked so well, we wanted to hold true to that. And I'm like, well, it's interesting that they, and back to that point, like, comparing it to Mighty No. 9, just as a person who's played both, like, this just feels so much better and, like, tighter, and the moment-to-moment gameplay just feels better. So I think they're nailing it in a way that Mighty No. 9 tried to do and failed.
Yeah,
sure. One of the questions that I had was, I think there was a lot of reaction about the fact that it was 2.5D, basically, instead of, you know, 2D like Mega Man 8 was.
Yeah.
And one of the concerns there is that always, like, with those games, like, readability is always kind of a thing of, like, I'm not sure what's in the foreground, I'm not sure what's in the background. Did you get a sense, like, they had something, like, did you ever get the sense, like, I can't distinguish between these two foreground background stuff, or is, like, did you ever get that sense at all?
It airs on the side, from what I saw from Reeves playing, it airs on the side of shockingly simple backgrounds.
Okay.
In time. So yeah, the artist even talked about that. Like, oh, how busy do we make the background? And there are moments where it's like, oh, this is not like a black screen behind him, but it's like, oh, that's much simpler background than I would have expected. Like, you know, the pyramid level and construction level. Construction level is a lot of darkness behind you. And then the pyramid level, it'll kind of have subtle stuff in the background, but never to the point of being overly distracting.
Yeah, I never had a problem with that. They do have the benefit of, like, HD screens and 4K screens, which they didn't have back when Mega Man 8
also,
came out.
Also, it's the first 16:9 Mega Man side-scroller.
Yeah, it's not only is it that, it's also zoomed out a little bit more, which maybe is part of due to the fact that it's, like, a widescreen game. But you see much more of the play field, which is nice, actually.
Yeah, the thing that is fascinating and trying to figure out how they're messaging this was really fun, of just the idea that they're like, hey, this isn't, he even said, quote, like, this isn't a trial balloon. Like, this is a true resurrection of Mega Man. We want him to be back in a big way. I asked, like, if it kind of tied into the overall push, because they're making that TV show. They're making a film, in theory, a film's in the works from the Catfish directors.
Live action?
Remember there was going to be a Lost Planet movie?
Oh, exactly. Look, this is probably going to fall through. You never know. But
remember
when
they,
like,
were making an Assassin's Creed movie?
Oh, yeah.
never
that
happened.
Never came out.
Yeah.
I think it's unfortunate. Forgot about that.
But they said, like, absolutely, it's part of the overall initiative of, like, a huge revival of Mega Man. And it's interesting. I would not call Mega Man 11 a budget game, but it seems very classic. Like, it seems like, from what we could gather, like, the same scope of an old Mega Man game, very much that style.
Right.
And so it's interesting to have a game that's like, oh no, Mega Man's back, it's here to stay. But it's also not like they're pouring $100 million into
this. It's not a 60-hour open-world game, basically.
Right. Yeah. I don't know. It's a fine line, but it's an interesting way to get out of the gate, an interesting thing to message.
Well, we did ask about price is it's going to be a $60 product, and they wouldn't say.
They said it was going to be physical release, though.
They did say it's going to be in a physical release.
Yeah.
So I don't, yeah, it's interesting because you usually don't put something out in a physical release that's less than $60 because it's seen as like an inferior product if it's not.
I think it's very smart of them to do it if it is less than $60, which I would hope that it is.
I don't, I think there are plenty of $40 physical releases and stuff too. But anyway.
I mean, well, yeah, Lost Legacy
there,
is something.
There are, but usually those are seen as budget games, right? There's kind of that perception around it. Yeah, I think people would totally pay $40 for this game, and I think if they nail it, it'll be worth $40 or more, maybe even.
Yeah,
but we're not ready to speak on that, obviously, yet. But it's just interesting. Like, they're kind of still thinking through, like, what's the price going to be? Is a game like this, in this old Mega Man style, robust enough? Is there enough meat on that to justify a big retail box release? I don't know. That's kind of still a question mark.
Yeah, definitely. So the game comes out in 2018, but
late 2018, I think.
Late 2018. Yeah. But if you go to GameInformer.com/Mega Man, we have a whole month of features rolling out with a lot of fun stuff. Some fun and silly stuff in there, right, Reeves?
Yeah.
Yeah. Mega Man 11, everybody.
I don't
check
know how much
out.
You want to pitch it. We pitched them Robot Master names. I have a whole list of Robot Master names that we did not get to pitch them on.
Did you pitch Batman?
Well, that was one of the pitches.
Okay. Hey, Ben Reeves, you want to grab this sheet?
Oh, really? Did you have this planned?
It's, you know, like, I thought about it.
It's almost like I had known you were going to do this.
That is not the case.
But it's not
so the case. We have a video going up. Yeah, Reeves pitching Robot Masters, and part of it was like, we're going to pitch Robot Master names. But the way the video flowed, it like worked backwards from a name, so there's no chance to pitch names. So we had all this wasted. But you want to just quickly run through these, Reeves?
Are we going back and forth?
Yeah, these were going to be our joke names.
You guys can tell us if they're good.
Okay, yeah.
Sure. Specifically by laughing.
They're all good, by the way. Okay. So the first one, Mailman.
Wheelman.
Half Man.
Mountain Man.
Basically God Man.
Jump Man.
Ultraman.
John Goodman.
Juana Man.
I Love You Man.
Encino Man.
The Elephant Man.
Rain Man.
Batman.
Invisible Man.
Chun-Li.
It's just like your opinion, man.
Talisman.
Working Man.
Middle Man.
Every Man.
What Makes a Man.
Fresh Man.
Mansion Man.
Powerful Female Protagonist Man.
Leslie Man.
German.
Bogey Man.
Bogey Man?
Bogey Man?
Bogey Man.
Death of a Salesman.
Bald Man.
College Improv Man.
Wet Mulch Man.
Tax Man.
Wicker Man.
Married Man.
Mega Man Legends 3 Man. Those were going to be the jokes we were going to say.
I think Mansion Man is the winner there.
Also, there's a Tell Me I'm a Good Man.
The joke I liked that Hansen did that axed was like, I would say Batman, then Spider-Man, and then Super Nuts Man. Which got a chuckle out of these two.
Okay.
No good. Anyways, hey, what's that music? Is it time for a special guest, you guys? Tim Turi from Capcom. Welcome back to the Game Informer Show, sir.
Hey. Oh, hi. How are you guys?
Really good. Really good. You're on with the full crew here. Tim, we felt bad because we spent a lot of time over there in Osaka with you. And, well, your eye line is completely off for the video version. But we spent so much time in Osaka with you, and you didn't really pop up throughout our month of coverage. And it's like, it is a shame not to tap into Tim Turi's knowledge about the Mega Man series, and especially because now you're working on Mega Man 11. So thanks for coming on.
Well, yeah, fortunately you had some other experts on hand with Tsuchiya-san and the people making the game. So
yeah, they definitely know a thing or two. What is your actual title for Mega Man 11 then?
I'm doing marketing on the game.
Wow. Okay, so what has your life been like? Is it tough to keep this secret? What's it like to finally say Mega Man 11?
Oh, man. Yeah, it's been really weird being able to, like, it started happening like in the last week or so where we started saying, like, the words Mega Man 11 out loud, and it felt a little bit like swearing in church or something like that. like church is not in session, but like I feel like I shouldn't be saying this. But it's also been really cathartic to be able to talk about it openly.
Tim, I'm sorry, do you want to just scream out the name of the game just once and for all publicly, just to get out of your system?
Mega Man 11. Right, feels really good.
It's pretty good. Are you in the church right now?
Is that an okay? I didn't want to spike the levels. I'm sorry.
No, you can spike it all you want. I think that's all right. It was really stressful for us, Tim. And so I can't imagine what it was like for you guys at Capcom. But especially when we Skyped you in during Extra Life, it's like, oh, we should play Mega Man Cross Street Fighter. And that was like after the cover story trip. And so, like, oh, let's talk about Mega Man for an hour without talking about the super exciting thing about Mega Man.
I just made sure to, like, look up a bunch of, like, cheat codes and stuff so that we had had other things to talk about. But yeah, that's always like the thing in the back of your head where you're like, the burden of the knowledge, you know what I mean? And yeah, we did know about it back then. So it was like, oh, I just don't want to accidentally slip up and say something that I don't. And that's just the constant terror. But you guys know that too from like being on cover story trips and stuff, and like you gotta be good at keeping secrets, which this turned out to be a really well kept secret. Like as a combination of like you know, everybody on the team just like being really careful and like playing it right along the way. Like we were able to me, like surprises are super important. Like I hate spoilers. I love surprising other people. I love surprise parties. Like, so the fact that this was actually a surprise was like just basically a dream come true.
You did a really good move on the live stream when we were playing that Mega Man Street Fighter. You're like, oh, what made you guys choose this game? I was like, all right. Good, well played, Tim. We have to be on our feet.
But we knew that he was like, I mean, you've been working on the Legacy Collection 1 and 2 and whatnot for a while. So it kind of loosely tied in and stuff. But talking about like having the big surprise, it must have been like a weird, I don't know if bittersweet is the right terminology, but I feel like expectations maybe were a little bit lower for that stream. And you guys were like hyping it up. But I think there were a lot of people in forums that were like, all right, we've gone through this song and dance before. What could they possibly show us? But then just to know that in your back pocket, you have Mega Man 11, Legacy Collection 1 and 2 coming to the Switch, and all of the X games also coming out, a new collection. Like, you just knew that you were ready to fire on all cylinders. That must have been really satisfying just to finally get that out there.
Yeah, it was great to be able to see everyone like speculating and wondering what we might show or might not show, and then just knowing that like, okay, well, all like reading everyone's speculation, and like some people were really right, some people were close, and then to have something for most of the people that were watching, like was super satisfying. You know, I think I'm like really neurotic in the way that it's like, even if you get like this awesome, something that you think is like really awesome and ready and like a really cool show in the case of like what we did on Monday, you just worry it's not enough. Like sometimes you worry that it's like not going to be enough after all, because we all hold ourselves to super high standards over here. And so like seeing the reception and seeing like the reaction to from everybody and the excitement over it was like super cathartic. And you know, bittersweet's I think a good word for it, because it's like so much work going up towards getting the news out there. And it's kind of like that little ramp up to the excitement, like get that pop out there and get the buzz going. But it's like, you want to keep on going. Like,
yeah. Also the fact that it didn't leak ahead of time is really nice.
It's crazy.
Cause it feels like there's so many times where it's like, hey, this company is planning a live stream on Monday, get ready. And then the Friday before it's like, oh, yep, it's a new Deus Ex game or whatever. You know, it's like...
Yeah, and especially, I mean, it's nice to have the Mega Man on the cover of Game Informer. There's something just, like, cool and classic. It reminds me of, like, the Mario U cover in a way where it's just cool to have, like, full-frame gaming icon on the Game Informer cover if he's never been there before.
Yeah, I mean, like, you actually just nailed it there, where it's just, like, seeing that character underneath, like, the Game Informer logo, and it's just super blue, and you got the entire like every representation of the Mega Man's out from the covers of the games over the years, like that, like,
which one's your favorite?
I've seen just a ton of people talking about the art itself online, and like I thought it came together like super well.
Yeah, for sure.
Mm-hmm. A lot of people are lining that on their like wall.
Yeah, just because I'm a huge dork, Tim, and care about you know, video production and stuff, I was fascinated by the challenge of, all right, you have an hour stream celebrating Mega Man's 30th anniversary. You have a bazooka in your pocket of Mega Man 11. When in the stream do you do it, right? If you do it too early, then it's tough to sustain momentum. If you do it at the very end, then people are going to tune out if it's 30, you know, if it's an hour of talking about, like, do you remember Mega Man 7? Boy, do I ever. What is that process like of determining when you launch that within that hour?
That's a good question. You know, it was you know, like, we put our heads together as a team and like really iterated on like the run of show and really try to get like in the headspace of what a Mega Man fan might be like sitting down and what we would like from a live stream like that. And, you know, I think, yeah, it's like you got the X games coming to like current platforms. And I think that to me was kind of like something that people, I saw a lot of requests for that online, and like as a fan of those games, I love the option of playing those on modern platforms too. But so it's like kind of getting out there with a nice I don't want to say just like a kind of like a not an easy win, but like just a something that everyone can feel good about, you know, and get that news out there so that some people are maybe wondering like, okay, that's cool, but is that it? I don't know. And then talk about the X series for a while, and then hit them with a 1-2. So that was kind of some of our discussions around it, was just kind of like a little bit of a misdirection, and then hit them with that.
Yeah, yeah. Joe, I feel like I cut you off 6 times from asking a question.
Hmm?
Never mind. Hey, we got some community questions no. here, Tim. I'll pipe you in. So Jeremy Marsh wants to know, he says, hey guys, Enries, or anybody else, you're welcome to jump in. Is Mega Man 11 feeling more like a traditional Mega Man game with precise jumps, unforgiving enemies, or is it leaning more towards the Mega Man X style with Metroid style power-ups? Reeves or Tim? Reeves,
yeah. I mean, I can definitely answer. I don't know if Tim, you want to jump in too, but
Reeves,
definitely,
you started off.
Yeah, it feels, after playing it, like, feels very classic Mega Man. Like, tight controls, definitely. The enemies are, I wouldn't say unforgiving, but there's definitely like a learning curve there. It's like you learn their patterns and then you know how to overcome them. But the first time you encounter one, you might get hit and you're like, oh, I didn't expect him to do that, kind of a thing. Same with the platforming, but it all feels tight and fair.
Yeah.
And then, I mean, we certainly didn't see any Mega Man X style upgrades, so I can't say that they're in there or not, but it definitely feels like a really classic Mega Man, original Mega Man.
There's a reason they call it Mega Man 11.
Right, right. I mean, yeah, there's the slide instead of the dash, for example.
Right, stuff like that.
But yeah, Tim, I don't know if you have anything to add to that.
Yeah, I mean, from my perspective, you know, obviously this one is fitting like within the chronology of the original series, so it does feel that way. And yeah, you know, I like all types of side-scrolling platformers. Like, that's one of my favorite genres. And so whenever you're dealing with like a side scroller that is based on 2D gameplay but has, you know, 3D character models, you know, sometimes that feel can be, you know, it's inconsistent across different games. But I think something that this is doing really well is that there was actually an interview with Ishihara-san, the art director and character designer for Mega Man 11, and he's pointing out specifically like that challenge of some games that use 3D assets and 2D gameplay, and the combination of like the hand-drawn super pretty backgrounds and just making sure that the perspective is just right. I don't know. I find, like you were saying, Reeves, that it does feel really precise, and it plays, does one of those things. Maybe this is a little bit of a cliche, but it kind of plays how I remember it. That's how I feel. So that is to say, I think it's really responsive and tight. And then there is the one Robot Master power that is shown in the trailer, you know, dropping the cubes from the air. And when you use that, it actually can, you know, change the way that you get around a level, like in the case where you're like destroying some pieces of the environment ahead of time, and that gives you like some different paths to go through. But yeah, it definitely feels like I think it should.
Yeah, Tim, I mean, you've been playing so much, so many of the old games, working on Legacy Collections and stuff, and then you've also played Mega Man 11, I'd imagine. And so Corey's asking specifically, I mean, would you say movement speed, jump arc, bullet speed, everything is about the same as those old games?
I don't want to say it's the same, because the development team is like really, really making care to make this, it's like a new game,
yeah,
that can appeal to everybody. But yeah, I mean, I can't get into the nitty-gritty of like how many, you know, what's the shot speed and like, you know, exactly how long it takes the three shots that you can get to go across the screen and stuff like that, and what the jump arc is like. But it feels right. You know, Reeves, I don't know what you think, but I think it feels right. Whether it's like 1-to-1, if you overlapped it with the 8-bit games, like I think that they'd be different. But within the context of like the new game and the world that they're creating, it feels like,
yeah,
classic Mega Man.
I think you nailed it when you said it feels like I remember it. And it does. It feels like I remember those old Mega Man games. So whether or not it's like 1-to-1,
right,
bullet speed, all that, I don't know.
Yeah.
But it feels good. And one thing that I found interesting was Oda-san had challenged the entire development team to play through the original Mega Man games as well as the Mega Man X games. And so they're all coming from a space of like, we remember how that series works and plays,
yeah,
and feels, because we just played them.
And the producer also worked on,
yeah,
5.
Yeah, and the producer started, yeah, right, work on, yeah.
Yeah.
I will say that I had played, you know, like Mega Man 1 through 10 and had been going on like a huge sprint through the entire series, and just like loved going back to them, and that I felt like all of the sort of skills I've been brushing up on leading up to, you know, the reveal of Mega Man 11, it feels like that pays off. Like, it feels like it absolutely translates, you know, timing, you know, when you're going to attack certain enemies and things like that. You know, when a Met peeks out from underneath its helmet, like that stuff, that kind of muscle memory still feels right.
Yeah. Emmanuel from Puerto Rico is going my favorite route of the game industry, and it took 0.2 seconds before the chat went this route too, of like the if you give a mouse a cookie situation. So he's like, hey, now I just want a Mega Man X9. Like, of course, just floodgates are open, everyone requesting everything that is not given to them yet. But he's specifically asking, is Tim Turi to blame for all the good coming out of Capcom recently? And has blame. He secretly become the its messiah? Is an exact question from Emmanuel on Tim. Tim, are you the Messiah or not?
I think we should have Joe answer this one.
Yeah, I'll feel bad for Tim. He is not as great as you think he is.
Thank you.
We're not talking about the Messiah right now.
he's got some real problems.
I mean, like, all these. I don't know if people understand how long it takes to get video games in development and, like, what prototyping and, like, getting them through is, but it is never a single person that's responsible for any of it. And I'd also, obviously, whether it's Resident Evil 7 or Mega Man 11, like, the heavy lifting and the real heroes are all in Osaka, Japan, like, working hard on all these games. I'm just lucky enough to be along for the ride. Like, my timing is, like, I am incredibly fortunate. Like, I got in the door here and was shown Resident Evil 7, and, like, this is really something special, and I cannot wait for the world to see this. And then as soon as I found out about Mega Man 11, it was just like, holy God, like, are you kidding me? Like, in my opinion, like, you know, just two of, like, what are the most important entries in both of these franchises, which are near and dear to my heart. Like, being able to hop on the ride and work with, like, an awesome team across both Japan and the U.S. We worked with Ted and Stephanie in Japan on the Mega Man 11 trip, and, like, it's been fantastic. So I just have good timing.
A Messiah should be humble. You're right.
Hey, number one criteria. Question here from Joe Juba from Minneapolis. When do we get to hear more about Dragon's Dogma 2?
Hey, cool. Here from Ben Hansen here in Minneapolis. Tim, he's wondering, what's your personal game of the year?
Oh, man. What a question. So if you remove, like, all Capcom games from it, that's not fair. It's really tough. I haven't gotten enough time to really reflect on Mario Odyssey, but it's been just, like, an amazing game. I beat it. I've been working on getting all the moons and absolutely adore it. But obviously Breath of the Wild was, like, a huge game for me. But I really liked Horizon as well. I had a lot of time with Persona 5, but obviously no one in the world's beaten that game.
The question wasn't list every game you played this year.
Yeah, we can all list games, Tim. We need one with a bullet.
Now it still feels like Breath of the Wild.
Yeah, there we go.
It's a good one.
But, man, I love some 3D Marios. So I just need, like, it won't be until I'm, like, sitting down and writing my own list for fun and just where it will suss out. But right now it feels like Breath of the Wild. And the nice thing is that the DLC will be out, I think, pretty soon, right? So
We've been talking about it very soon on the Game Informer show, so stay tuned. Tim, we love you. Thank you so much. It's nice to have you as a temporary co-host again, but we've got to let you go. You can go do some marketing bonanza stuff from Mega Man 11 there. Yeah.
Dragon
Thanks Dogma, for having me on, guys, and until next time, don't be afraid to give me a ring.
Okay, bye, Tim. Yeah.
Bye, see ya.
Bye.
All right, hey, Joe, do you want to clap out of here so we can talk about Destiny?
Yeah, see ya.
Matt Miller, Lord Saladin himself, as we call you. Welcome to the show.
Can I clap back out?
Nope, you have to stay here and talk about Destiny 2, Curse of Osiris. Sorry.
We're in a rush, but not that much.
Yeah, welcome to the big show. Destiny 2, Curse of Osiris, we've talked about it before. Surreal went over to Bungie, played through a fair amount of it. Miller, you're starting to dabble with it. You're kind of in a first impressions arena.
Yeah.
Early impressions, but you finished the campaign, yes?
Yeah, I mean, it's not a long campaign. This is in the sphere of Destiny style expansions.
Yeah.
It's closer
to House of Wolves.
It's like House of Wolves Dark Below more than it is Taken King Rise of Iron.
Okay.
Scope wise.
And what do you think?
I think it's good. It suffers under the time that it is coming out, at which point the community that enjoys that game, or in some cases is not enjoying that game, has a lot to say.
Yeah.
And the early response to it, I think, has been framed around some of those frustrations. And I'm caught in the middle, because I am one of those enthusiasts for the game who does have some problems with where the end game is and some of the things that they're offering and the focus on microtransactions and all that kind of stuff. Yeah. At the same time, I'm also pretty cognizant of the nature of game development and the fact that some of the biggest concerns that have arisen for the Destiny community have come up in the last month and a half. And guess what state Curse of Osiris was in a month and a half ago? I mean, it was
probably mostly done.
Is there anything to be said, though, for, like, is there any way they can separate more out? Just like, all right, the campaign, the story.
Mm-hmm.
But in terms of, like, balancing and remapping the end game and stuff, maybe you can cook those in two separate pots forward, you know?
I think part of the dilemma here is that they, and by they, I mean Bungie. Bungie has invited that kind of evaluation from its community because of the way they've set up their new structures. The major balance change for the game, the first major balance for the change, went in on the same day as this expansion went in.
Oh, okay.
The new season of content where you start your clan over and you start re-leveling your clan for a new clan banner, that also started with this expansion launch. And so I think it's very easy for the community to conflate the two things, even though ultimately you're talking about one thing is a piece of content where you're going to play through a short campaign and you're going to get some new rewards connected to that. And the other thing is broader issues connected to the game as a whole and how it continues to grow.
Okay.
By the way,
last week when Bungie posted the blog saying, like, hey, this is the roadmap for the future of Destiny. Yeah. We hear your concerns. Here's what we have in mind. Here's things we're changing. You and Surreal and Tack recorded an hour-long discussion. Yeah. So if you want, like, a deep dive into, like, Destiny 2 systems and mechanics, you can find it on the Game Informer site, Game Informer's YouTube channel. But I'm sorry, Miller, go ahead.
No, I think that's a good thing to point out. I mean, I'm approaching the expansion with an eye towards both those things.
Okay.
Right? But I do think that it would be easy to get caught up in recent dilemmas with the game and ignore that there's, you know, some fun stuff here.
What is fun? Surreal, what struck you as the most fun?
I think the campaign is pretty fun. I think it is short, but I think it is maybe some of the most cohesive storytelling they've done so far, not to sort of go too deep into it. I think it benefits from being just this brief short story, whereas I think a lot of, especially in Destiny 1, it felt very confusing to go from one point to another and try to get a sense of the larger scale.
But when you're just focusing on Mercury, it benefits
right.
from that.
From yeah. this one short story, I think
it's just about Osiris,
right.
basically. Like, where has Osiris been? What's he doing? And let's go save him. He is, I would say the only thing that's maybe unfortunate about the way they structured the story is Osiris ends up being this kind of MacGuffin to the story rather than the main character.
You want him more in, like, a kid role, like, running alongside you.
Well, I think I'd like to see a little bit more of him and learn a little bit more about him through the process of the story rather than, you know, most of what you get to see of him and hear from him is packed into the last, like, 45-second cinematic.
So it's a Luke Skywalker, Force Awakens
yeah,
situation.
There's, like, a little bit of that quality to it, actually.
He's in the intro, and then he bookends the experience, and then the rest of it is, yeah. like, here's, like, his trail that he's left behind.
Right.
That's almost disappointing because, like, Osiris is this kind of legendary figure
yep.
you kind of like hear a lot about, especially in the first game. It's kind of like, oh, it'd be interesting to meet that guy.
Yep.
And this is the time to meet him, but it sounds like not totally.
Well, and I think the other thing that's maybe a little disappointing, not to, again, I'm actually with you, Suriel. I do like the story and the campaign playthrough, but the other thing that disappointed me a little bit about how they handled Osiris is that at the, how do I say this without spoiling anything? I'll just say that Osiris, I was hoping for him to be positioned into a new major role at the end of the story.
Like he's on the tower somewhere.
And without saying exactly where things end up, I don't know that that's how they do it. It's more that like he's just kind of another guy out there.
Hmm.
That's maybe a little bit of a bummer. But the campaign itself, the biggest thing I like about it is, and I'm curious about your thoughts on this, Surreal, is just it's really beautiful. I think maybe just the individual like areas you're moving through, some of them are just really breathtaking in the way that Destiny 2, I think, doesn't get as much credit as it deserves for how great the art is in these different settings, these sort of grand sci-fi environments.
Right.
And this one's awesome.
Yeah.
I mean, it really taps into that, the sort of the mythology of the Vex, which is one of the big alien enemies in the game, And there's sort of these iconic block structures that they have, but it layers on top of that these other elements connected to the past and the future of the Vex.
Yeah,
and
so like I've just played through like, you know, multiplayer maps that take place on Mercury, so you have mm-hmm. a vague idea of mm-hmm. what it's going to be like. Is it more of that type of environment, just a lot of yellow, or does it shake it up beyond that?
They're really good at skyboxes. They're really good at giving you these amazing vistas. But I think one thing that I think makes those environments stand out is that they play into them a little more. Like in Destiny 1, it felt like you were the environments were the stages where the story took place, whereas I think in Curse of Osiris they do a better job of like, here's a weird location, we're gonna talk about the specifics of that location as you're playing through it, so it makes you sort of more invested in the areas you're in without you know, spoiling too much.
The original Destiny release had the raid Vault of Glass, which one of the most compelling aspects of that first raid was the idea you were encountering Vex from across different timelines and different moments in history, and the final conflict, you were actually moving between the same space in multiple timelines, and that it was kind of this weird sci-fi experience.
Yeah.
This game doubles down on that a little bit and gives us a little bit more of that flavor of the idea that this weird, enigmatic, robotic race
exists across time.
Exists across time and has these multi-layered like reality experiments that they're playing out across, you know, literally billions of years.
And are they unstuck in time? Yeah. Are they seeing everything?
Well,
what are they doing?
It's still, I think they leave it a little enigmatic. I would say one of the other things that they start to flirt with here that they've always hinted at with the Vex is that they're constantly doing these simulations of reality that are basically reality once you enter them. Like you can die in them and that kind of thing.
In this reality, there's a thriving endgame for Destiny 2.
They haven't found that one yet. Haven't calculated it.
There's a and so they've started to play around a little bit with that idea. It's almost underused here, I think.
Yeah, I think before release, they were really hyping up the Infinite Forest, which is supposed to be this procedurally generated sort of interlocking areas where it'd be basically one combat arena to the next that were random, that were basically...
There were random simulations by the Vex of like, this is what would happen if the Fallen took over the solar system. Like,
but
that
it's a way
kind
to kind of get their Chalice Dungeon type thing from Blood Sword.
Yeah, but I feel like it's... Yeah, like,
but
like
it's not
said,
used
it's,
that
it's
way
It's
yet.
Underutilized. It's, yeah, because it felt like, okay, I mean, I guess I haven't memorized the combat encounters in Destiny to a point where it's like, okay, I guess this is different, but like it still boils down to the fact that the things you are fighting are still fundamentally the same thing. It's just, here's sort of the harpies, here's, you know, the demons, which are the new sort of like enemies
the
with more health.
Yeah.
So it I don't know that it does as much to freshen up sort of the environments as much as I think Bungie wanted them to.
Yeah. But the environments themselves just visually are awesome. It's another awesome soundtrack, which is another thing I think is always worth highlighting with Destiny, because they do great soundtracks.
Are you surprised by that? I guess I never really dove into it. Were you expecting a drop off after Marty O'Donnell left? Because he's kind of the face of the music.
I don't know if I was expecting a drop off, but I will say that I was very impressed with Destiny 2, which, by the way, is not to diminish Destiny 1's soundtrack and Marty O'Donnell's involvement with it, because that is one of my favorite soundtracks of all time. But I think that they have done a phenomenal job of keeping up the musical depth of that universe and lending it added weight and poignancy and emotion through its music.
I will say, as someone who the Destiny soundtrack is sort of present but not always sort of at the forefront of what I think about Destiny.
Reese, hang in real quick. Can you remind me, how does the Destiny soundtrack go again? Okay, go ahead, Surreal. Really good.
It felt like they did a pretty good job in their short time runtime of sort of having one melody and sort of iterating on it so that okay, this is the Osiris theme and you're hearing it again and under new context. So it sort of did a pretty good job of having a through line throughout the whole experience.
Yeah. Miller, do you remember when we were on the Destiny 1 cover story trip mm-hmm. and we interviewed Marty O'Donnell? And like the Destiny 1 chime that would always come up, the kind of theme with like the dun dun dun. It sticks with me so much that he said, hey, I liked it because it's like you can say the word destiny.
Well, you're getting the melody wrong, but that's fine.
Oh, whatever. I'm pretty sure I'm pitch perfect.
It was a three-note thing.
Right. It's a little bit like like the Close Encounters thing. Like they chose like the five notes because they're like, oh, it's like hello. And it's always, it's so silly, but I always think of that dumb Destiny thing. And his, anyways, so Curse of Osiris.
Here's the thing. Like, I haven't played any Crucible yet. There's a balance change that went in that should affect some things about the way classes are playing against one another. There, that affected weapon balance and changed up some stuff related to grenades. Pulse grenades, I think, maybe won't be as dominant, or at least the aim was to have them not be as dominant as they have been. There's a lot of that kind of stuff I haven't messed around with yet. The raid layer thing that they have talked about is not yet present for us.
Raid layer?
Yeah, that's their new thing with the raid. It's not a totally new raid.
Oh.
It's a raid
light sort of.
Well, we don't know. It's like a monster layer inside of the previous raid.
Like a new room?
There's new encounters, and we just don't know much about it.
They said
it's
going to be shorter than the main raid, but it's still going to have like brand new encounters.
Yeah. So that's not there yet. Hmm. I haven't. There's a lot of stuff I haven't messed with yet. So I'm holding off on like making calls about stuff. I will. One thing, just straight up, that I will say is that like, this game continues to bother me more with its focus on microtransactions. Like,
they haven't changed that.
No.
Okay.
They changed the name. They've gone from Bright Engrams to Illuminated Engrams.
Illuminated Engrams.
Oh, that changes everything.
But yeah. It feels like at this point there was more effort almost put into making sure that system was going to keep on getting people to spend money. Hmm. And
you think that'll change in the coming months? Like, a lot of this was probably made before the EA stuff hit the fan, so maybe
I don't know.
It's pullback from
it's,
that.
Whenever I have a conversation about like loot box things at this point, I have to remind myself that as much as I personally hate them with a deep and abiding passion, I recognize their importance within the current economy of how our favorite game makers are making games. And like Bungie and Activision are fueling the making of Destiny content by the loot boxes. Now, does that forgive it? No.
No. Should players care about that?
No, they shouldn't. But I am reminded of the fact that players, much as they shouldn't forgive that or whatever, are still paying for them.
Right.
Or else they wouldn't be in there. And not only are they paying for some of them, they're paying for huge, huge sums of money of them that often outstrip the purchase cost of the content piece that you're getting.
Yeah.
And it's not like Curse of Osiris is free. It is a paid content.
Yeah.
Download.
How much is it?
It's like $30 for both DLCs. So
and it's Curse of Osiris and an upcoming one?
Well, Curse of Osiris, yeah, it's Curse of Osiris and then
an expansion
one.
2.
Yeah, expansion 2.
I think a lot of people probably also maybe have the addition of the base game that just came with the first two expansions.
Oh, okay.
Depends on how you cut it. But suffice to say, whether I like it or not, I don't. They're making a bunch of money. There's so much money that they're making on these things, and so that's why they're still there.
Yeah.
But I don't like it. I feel like the rewards that are part of that system, the ships, some of the armor sets, the exotic ornaments would all help the end game be more robust.
Yeah.
They were built into the mechanics of progression, but they're not.
Yeah.
And so it really is one of these situations where I feel like I and a lot of other people have been like harping on this for years, saying like, this is where it's going to go in this direction. That's really going to make games not as fun as they could be. And we're there, man. Like, this game is not as fun as it could be because of this stuff.
Yeah.
I don't like it, but it is still, I think it's fair to say it's an important part. It's worked pretty centrally into the mechanics.
Mm-hmm. I mean, a thing that's always at the bottom of the screen of like, here's when you're gonna get your next loot
thing
drop. And like, if you paid money, you could be getting more stuff.
You could,
and like,
you could get them faster, and you could get more ships, and you could get more exotic ornaments.
As people said recently, welcome to hell. We are here right now.
I do think that they do a decent job of sort of.
They may have been referencing something
How's
else,
that?
But don't worry about that.
Okay. They did add some like post campaign. It sort of does open up like a lot of the other Destiny things. Like, there are now heroic strikes that you can do, which are harder versions of regular their strikes, and they give you a new powerful engram, which helps with the weekly milestone stuff. There's new daily heroic missions, which I'm kind of ambivalent about because I hated them in the first game because there was no matchmaking for them and they were always very difficult. So it was one of those things where I'm just gonna have to find people to play these with, and because they're always frustrating to do on your own. But Yeah, some of the Macro Gen Sanctuary stuff kind of sours it a little bit.
I don't love that stuff, but I am having fun with Curse of Osiris so far. I like the campaign. I think it's beautiful visually. I think it's got some great new music. It gives us some more chance to play around with the Vex, which is my favorite of the alien races. We get to meet Osiris after such a long time of like having him hinted at. And there's some new stuff in there for like helping the end game. It is not a solution to the end game problems, but there are some new ornaments to chase, some new armor sets to go after, some new exotics to look for that I think give some stuff to do for players who are looking for it. And so I'm definitely not in the camp of like, this is terrible. I hate this thing. Everything about Destiny sucks right now. I can't totally buy into that. I feel like the expansion is certainly not the be all end all fix to the end game problems of Destiny 2. But I do think what I've played of it so far is fun. And somebody else who had fun with the base game of Destiny 2, I mean, wouldn't you think they'd have a good time with what you've played of it?
Yeah, I think they would enjoy themselves. It's just a matter of like expectations play a lot, large part. Do you want this to be your hobby? Do you want it to be something you pick up and put down? It's sort of like Destiny's always been somewhere in between those two extremes.
Yep.
So it's always difficult for them to deliver on something that like appeases both of them.
Yeah.
So the music's good.
Overall, with that huge video you guys did last week and the blog update. Overall, one word, Miller. I know this is so hard.
Come
one on. Word. Future of Destiny 2, and maybe overall Destiny. Surreal, optimistic or pessimistic?
Optimistic. I think Destiny. Okay.
Miller,
optimistic.
All right, there we go. Curse of Osiris out now. Check it out. Cool. Thank you so much, guys. We got to move on to emails.
But, all right.
I'll miss you dearly, Miller.
I'll miss you too.
Bye.
Bye.
And welcome back to the Game Informer Show. We have some great emails that the community sent in to podcast@gameinformer.com. That email address, one more time, Surreal, is
podcast@gameinformer.com.
What are you doing with the mic there? Fix your mic, you weirdo. And also, we lost Matt Miller, but we got Joe Juba back.
Yay!
Tell from the raspy laugh. All right, so people sent in questions. They had feedback for us, comments, everything under the sun. They sent it to podcast@gameinformer.com. We're going to read through all these, choose our absolute favorite of the bunch, and then ship them out something really nice. Again, send anything you want to podcast@gameinformer.com. I won't delete a single email. I might not include it on the show, but I'll read everything. Anything you think makes the show better.
Hanson gives great advice.
Okay. All right.
Sometimes, an advice column, actually.
Sometimes I
nice.
Respond privately. Yeah, there's something very sweet. All right. Speaking of sweet, first email is Steven from Los Angeles, and he says, hello, GI buds. Food for thought. Referring to a game's controls as buttery technically means you're calling it difficult to grasp.
What? Technically?
I mean,
it's smooth, right?
I don't understand if this is like...
Mouth technically?
No, has there been just some sort of like official call on this that we're ignorant about? Or
if you're saying the controller's buttery, I would get it. It's hard to hold on to, but you're talking
controls
about the controls
being buttery. You're saying the concept of the controls could be hard to grasp because everyone knows how impossible it is to grab a stick of butter.
I feel like the metaphor there is that it is smooth like cutting butter.
Yeah, smooth.
Cutting like butter versus cutting cheese. Two dairy products means very different things.
Well, unless you're cuttering cold butter.
Hey, you guys remember? Hard. You guys remember Cut Man?
Remember Cuttering Man? Yeah.
Okay, let's go.
All right, next question. Here we go. Flying through them. Next question is from the universe, and it's writing into Surreal Vasquez saying, hey, could you start a new recurring series where you let us know what that new Super Mario cereal tastes like?
Thank you, universe.
Sure.
Y'all ready for this?
Oh, absolutely.
Oh, here we go. Leo.
Wait a minute. You just had this? What a coincidence.
It's the song.
Did we get an early copy of Super Mario cereal?
Oh my god, when does this come out, Surreal? Tell us all about it.
I don't know when it comes out, but...
I don't think you guys are appreciating Leo's remix of Hey Mikey, He Likes It.
Oh, is that what this is?
Yeah.
That's really good.
Well, not only is that what this is, this marks the debut of the positively 100% recurring series that we're affectionately calling Surreal, Surreal, Serial, Seriously, Serial Series.
That's right. I don't know why you said we are calling it. We've been calling it that.
That's right. And we will be started. For many proud years
That's
to
right.
come.
All
right. Surreal, make that cereal.
Okay, guys. This is the Super Mario cereal. It's mixed berry cereal with marshmallows. As you all know, it's got a special property of being an amiibo, so you can cut this out and take it with you to school or work or wherever you use your amiibos.
Wait, the cereal is an amiibo?
Each individual yes. piece of the cereal?
No.
Okay.
The box. The box is...
So you rub that box of cereal mm-hmm. onto a new 3DS.
Like, pretend my hand is a Switch. Do you do this?
Ugh.
And you just get whatever fun bonuses you would get
Joe,
out of it.
Does the future suck or is it cool?
I think it really sucks.
Hold on.
I will say it's kind of bad that they say this box is a special amiibo when it is the exact opposite. It's literally a generic amiibo. It does nothing that a unique amiibo would do. It is like putting amiibo zero on your thing.
I think it's pretty special how slow you're pouring that cereal into that bowl.
I'm getting into it. There's a maze on the back, by the way.
You're going to have to figure this out for future episodes okay. of this
gosh.
Series.
Did you guys hear that? It's like a thunderstorm of people hitting the subscribe button.
That's right.
Oh my god, it's coming through.
Rich, oh my god.
It's coming through.
Should I? All right, I'm going to put on the mic here.
Okay.
Oh, that's good.
Oh, that's a good
We're not breaking any embargoes by reviewing this.
I'm sorry about getting dust all over this thing.
Nintendo okay. did send us the cereal early. Apparently, it's on sale next week. Yeah, get the box.
So it's extra
there.
Fresh, though.
I want to see the box.
Oh, that smells
now,
like a cereal.
I was of the opinion that you could just kind of shove a hand in there and then eat some dumb cereal. But Surreal went out and bought milk, because Surreal knows cereal.
I mean, he's the guy. That's why we
I
got
have to
him
be thorough.
This
is my career's on the line.
Now, I've been meaning to ask you, what makes this cereal series serious?
The fact that, I mean, I went out and got milk. I will have a detailed post on the site.
No, he's got no sense of humor about it.
That's right.
This is without irony.
That's right.
See?
I'm trying to open this spoon up. This
How much are we
spoon.
Paying for you for this, cereal?
Not much.
Yeah, that sounds right.
Trying to get into this thing.
I think everybody at this table has already eaten some.
Uh-uh.
Except
Go ahead,
for you.
Go ahead.
Yeah. I'm scooping you on it.
Yeah.
Oh.
Well, I'm trying to be serious about this, guys.
Don't weigh in on how it tastes until Surreal tastes it. He's the only verdict that matters. We're like the second opinion.
The spoon has a splinter in it, by the way, so
Surreal,
that'll be fun to eat.
We're going
on
minute six of you not eating
All right,
Mario
I'm going
cereal.
For it.
He's doing it, you guys. Right in that mic.
Mm-hmm.
Does he, in fact, like it?
Okay. Initial thoughts.
It's Lucky Charms.
There it is. Thank you so much for tuning in to the first episode ever of Surreal Series.
Like and subscribe, you guys, for more awesome cereal videos that I will definitely continue doing for the rest of my life forever.
Hell or don't. Anyways, next question. Chuck Blessman from Green Bay, Wisconsin says, "Hey, crew, I was wondering what your favorite home screen is on any of the consoles."
For Not me, the Xbox.
It has to go back. I think
oh,
it's
that Xbox One.
I think it's got to go back to just like regular PS2, probably.
Just the weird like skyscrapers. What are those?
Yeah. Well, and it's got to go back to a time before publishers could serve me ads on their dashboards.
Right.
So
right.
PS2.
But the concept of a dashboard back then is weird. Are we talking like disc tray open, just the landing screen?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
But there was nothing. So you don't like all the bells and whistles of being able to like download things off a store?
I do. What I don't like is the inability to like customize that. Like it's not modular in the way that I want it to be, right? Like I don't get to choose which content is easily accessible. It's always just like big dumb ad here, your big the last thing you did there. And you can like they let you like pin stuff. Well, I'm talking about Xbox One here specifically, but like.
But even the pins are like hard to find now.
Yeah,
I don't know.
And like
they need to take a cue from cell phones and like make me allow me to do everything I want.
Yeah, and I feel
whatever I want to this thing.
Yeah, I feel the same way about PS4 too. Is like there are lots of things in my sort of like, my string of icons or whatever that I'm just like I never do that. Just get like I started that
well,
game
PS4
once.
PS4 like has the games on there. I think it does an okay job.
Yeah,
at least the PS4 doesn't change every 6 months, and I'm like, how do I find that thing now?
Yeah, that's true. I just want a home screen. I mean, like you said, like your phone is exactly like just let me make my like my dashboard landing page exactly what I want it to be. Let me control that completely.
I thought the Blades were pretty decent. I mean, I think they kind of had to switch off them once the Xbox Live Marketplace got off and running. But
yeah.
I like the simplicity of, like, here are games, here is media, here is, you know, whatever. Here's the Xbox Live store on the separate tabs that you could quickly swap among.
Yeah, I hear you. As far as like a home screen, yeah. I think back just like, you know, disc tray open. I love the GameCube. I was reminded of it recently. We did like that memory card archaeology video of like digging around on the GameCube thing. Like just the sound, like like navigating that weird cube that you rotate around. I think is really cool on that thing.
I like that the music was, I think it would change slightly, right? Or
it was something weird, like it was something slowed down.
Maybe
the
color
GameCube
changed or something. Yeah.
Anyways, yeah, great. The only place I consider home is the GameCube home screen.
That's right.
Tyler from DC says, hey, folks, I was recently playing Warhammer Vermintide on Xbox One. It's free for gold. And it's actually got me thinking about the pick up and play aspect of games. While the game is fun, I'm finding myself not wanting to go back because of the in-depth mechanics of stats and whatnot. When I think of my favorite games, they tend to lean into aspects of simplicity and not be convoluted with in-depth menus and deep lore. Left 4 Dead, as an example. Zombie outbreak, get from A to B, shoot everything and survive. Easy enough. Twisted Metal, choose a car, take out the other cars. Survive. Easy. Do you think games sometimes get too cute with their mechanics instead of just making it more simple? It's Tyler from DC.
So wait, what's the example of getting too cute?
Vermintide and Xbox One. And I'll lump in Xenoblade Chronicles 2 based on the conversation last week, even though I haven't started it yet. But I really like this email. I think it stands out a lot. I mean, I think two of my favorite games of the year, Zelda and PUBG, are remarkably simple and clean. Especially yeah. PUBG. I know that it's intimidating for some people to get into, but I still think the beauty of that game is just, you can figure it out, be the last one standing, go. Like, yeah. Maybe some of the ammo is a little bit confusing at first, but Reeves, I recently indoctrinated you into PUBG.
Yeah. Yeah, I like PUBG. I like your Zelda example, too. Like, I feel like Zelda did a good job of stripping away all the, like, little dumb side quests that open world games always need to fill in on the map. And, like, it's, I feel like I'm just following a waypoint to here and there. One good example of a thing, recently playing Shadow of War.
Oh, yeah.
And there's things where you jump on the towers there. And to find the objectives, you have to play this dumb mini game of like this giant circle that you're trying to like search around the map, and like it slowly zooms in when you get close to where the objective is. I'm like, that's really dumb, guys. Just
those types
I do not need that. Just tell me where the next mission is.
Do they do like focus testing for those weird little one-offs in games? Like, does anybody say I had fun doing that?
No.
There's just so many of those weird little time fillers where it's like, yeah, there's no reason for this.
I imagine they just said, like, this will add maybe 2 hours to the game if we had this in.
I guess.
Yeah. Boy, I really disagree with you guys on the Zelda front, by the way.
I've never heard you express that opinion.
Yeah,
Jay.
I know.
I thought you liked breakable weapons.
Well, no, I mean, but more so than that, I mean,
think it's a good game.
There is something that is like simple about Zelda's approach to exploration and stuff, but I think that things like having to hunt down a bunch of weird seeds and give them to some person whose like location changes and stuff like that to like expand inventory slots and stuff.
Yeah, what game is that?
Yeah, okay, but really, Zelda, but like just the concept of boiling it down, do games overcomplicate themselves
too
much? Yeah,
okay. So not to focus on Zelda specifically, I think that there are two sides to this coin, because like on one hand you have people who don't.
I'm wearing a shirt on.
We don't need to relive that.
Not again.
He dumped some more cereal.
It's an old
on
episode
head.
Of the show.
It's like on one hand you have people who complain that games are too simple, right? That it's like it's
I've
always
yet to meet that person in my own skull.
Okay.
Okay.
But then
I haven't met that person either wearing these shoes.
I think the important distinction that comes up in the question is like needless complexity.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like I don't think I do not think that simply making a game easy to understand or making goals straightforward is always the best way to go. Not every game is Twisted Metal. Not everyone wants just kill other cars, survive, whatever. Some of us like games that have much deeper systems. And I think when you have a game like Xenoblade Chronicles 2, it goes a little too deep down that rabbit hole to make things that should be simple complicated.
No bunhole, yeah.
But at the same time, I like when the depth of those systems are there, they can really like enrich an experience.
Sure.
So, anyway.
Yeah. Brett Williamsville. I'm sorry, Brett Williams from Martinsville, Indiana, that is, God's country. He says, hey, crew, what is your favorite, or the best, the coolest, etc., battle sequence ever filmed? For me, the Battle of the Pelador Fields in Return of the King. Sorry, that was instinctual.
Why do you gotta make nerd sounds with that?
Pelador Fields. The Battle of the Pelador Fields in Return of the King is the best. It's lengthy, detailed, emotional, and the CGI still holds up today. It's also in my favorite movie of all time, so that helps. Anyways, keep up the great work. Thank you. I think this is an interesting question. Best battle sequence ever filmed outside of the world of games, unless it's the opening cutscene to like Onimusha 2 or something.
Yeah.
Or I guess you could cheat and choose like something from Advent Children that's basically
the action's pretty cool. In that movie.
I think the Cloud Sephiroth battle at the end of that is pretty rad. Anyway, I'm sorry, Ben. Go ahead.
Well, no, I was gonna say the airport scene in Civil War, Marvel Civil War.
Oh, that's
feels
a great
like
example.
Really hard to beat. It used to be, for me, it's another Marvel film, but the Avengers scene at the end of the first Avengers film in New York, I always thought was like an awesome action
Especially
scene.
Especially just that one tracking shot where it's going from every character to every character, even if they are just fighting, ooh, the Chitauri, what Lethal Warriors, like, whatever.
I pretty much only watch Marvel films at this point anyway. So.
I've got to go with the Kill Bill scene, the Crazy 88.
Mm. Oh, great choice.
That's a good one, actually.
Yeah, yeah. Mine's from TV, and it's recent. And I understand there's some dopey stuff where he's kind of being suffocated and piling up bodies is weird, but Battle of the Bastards in Game of Thrones, I think it was the last thing I watched, was like, this is one of the most amazing fight scenes I've ever seen in my life. And even though it gets silly with the bodies piling up, it really like reinforced a central theme that I'm not coming up with this. I heard some film theorists talk about it at some point, but just Spielberg is big on like establishing geography in films, and any scene, any movie, especially action scene where you have a clear sense of like, this person's here. They're trying to get here. Basically, as close as you can get to showing an overhead map of the situation as possible without being that literal, the better off it is. And I feel like Battle of the Bastards did a great job of like, you always knew exactly what was going on, where the sides were, what was closing off where, and also just that super long shot of just Jon Snow slashing people and people knocked off the horses. I think it's just incredible.
I don't know if this counts as like combat in the JRPG sense, but like I really like the action scenes in John Wick. I'm not as crazy about that series as a lot of other people are, but there's a scene specifically inside of his house where I think a couple people start to go in and try to kill him, and it feels like kung fu choreography but with guns, which I thought was really cool.
Yeah, all kung fu needs more guns. I'm with Surreal. Billy from Gloucester, Virginia says, hey, I have a serious question for you.
Ooh.
Get ready.
A serial question.
It's getting soggy over there, man. Dig in.
Is it okay for a toy, movie, or game featuring a T-Rex to use a roar other than the Jurassic Park T-Rex roar?
No.
I've heard different roars come out of T-Rexes before, and it makes me squirm like someone just scratched a chalkboard. It's not right. Should creators be allowed to experiment with their tyrant lizards and find something better, or should they stick to perfection? This really is speaking to me. Absolutely. There's like such a buildup whenever a T-Rex is about to roar in any medium, because I just lean back and go, it's not going to be the T-Rex roar. Right. This is going to suck.
Well, what about the T-Rex roar from Toy Story?
That's exactly it. Toy Story 3, there's a scene where Rex roars in the beginning, and they literally use the Jurassic Park roar. And that's probably why I like that movie so much. It's like, there's the first beat that it hits. It's like, well, this movie's going to be perfect.
There you go.
Jurassic Park roar in a Toy Story movie.
Sometimes
it's amazing.
I think you should let someone else choose the emails.
Oh, yeah. Maybe. Okay. All right. No thoughts on that. That's cool.
Do you have
cool.
any more Stardew questions on there?
That's just in. Rich Lynch from Yonkers, New York. He insists it's a real place, but there's no physical evidence of it. Rich says, hey, guys, I was wondering if you had any idea why Mark Hamill has never played Luke Skywalker in a Star Wars game.
He doesn't do voiceover.
The weird thing is, I looked it up. He has done how many dozens and dozens of like voiceovers for games, but he's never done Luke.
I wonder if that's just the weird thing where it's like if he wanted to be involved, like he knows the sort of value of that, and he would charge way too much, and the people making the game just like, let's just get another voice actor. It's not
anybody can be a dweeb.
That's right.
It's kind of weird because he was in the Wing Commander series, which is like another sci-fi adventure, but not. I mean, but not any of the Star Wars games. I don't know if it's just a matter of money, like Surreal's saying. Yeah. Like, that would be my guess.
I don't know.
There may be part of it, too, of, and again, total conjecture of just, like, wanting... He's already, like, inextricably tied. His identity as a celebrity is tied to that role. Of maybe wanting to, like, try and carve out something else rather than just being Luke Skywalker at every possible turn and
also
overshadowing
seems like he's,
anything else you ever do.
But he's so eager to be the Joker again and again and again, you know?
Well, yeah. I mean, that's not Luke Skywalker.
Just because it's not
that's,
Luke,
I mean,
I
that's
so.
A different identity. You
yeah,
know?
Even if he's done it longer. Well, maybe not.
Yeah, I mean, he is cemented as Luke, right? So it's like if he can cement himself as some other things and expand his, I don't know.
Yeah. That said, I just got to the part in Battlefront 2's campaign where Luke speaks and it's rough. Boy, that ain't Mark Hamill.
It is always really rough when you run into that character in a video game.
Forrest from Lauren says, simple question, but a good one. Hey, crew, what's the longest you've ever walked in one day?
18 miles.
Okay, great. Idea. Fantastic. Yeah. Sophie writes in and says, PSX is this weekend. Will you guys be attending? Also, what are your thoughts on PSX in general?
Some of us will.
Yeah,
I assume we can say Reiner and Andy and Imran will all be out there, so you can look out for them.
Definitely. And next week's podcast, we'll try and Skype some of them in, and also give a recap of everything they announced at PSX, because it's a big weekend for games between the Game Awards and PSX.
I think PSX is a cool weekend. I haven't been able to go, but I always like watching the news, and it's kind of fun to have that like second show outside of E3 that seems like Sony makes a push for.
Yeah,
I feel like this year is a little weird because felt like they also made a big push at Paris Games Week a month ago, and so it's like, well, what do they have left to show? I'm kind of curious to see what they roll out.
Yeah, I'm very curious too. It's a little bit of an open slate, hopefully. Do you think?
I don't.
Well, would they show more? Like maybe like Fantasy 7 footage? Like I'm trying to think of the long shots of things that are...
I mean, it sounds all signs. Wait, no, that's the Game Awards. I was going to say all signs point to more Death Stranding, but
yeah, that's Game Awards. Yeah, it's a weird split. Joe, this seems tailor-made for you. Nick from Atlanta wants to know what's worse, bad fetch quest or bad escort mission?
Oh, a bad escort mission is way worse.
Yeah, absolutely.
Because
the person can die.
So fetch quests are boring. That's not great design, but you at least have control over that.
Yeah.
Like you control what you're fetching and when and how versus an escort mission where like if you fail that so often, it feels like that was just out of your hands, which that's not a good feeling.
That ain't great. Jordan says, hey guys, it's Jordan from Dayton. Who do you think has the best beard in gaming?
Oh, that's easy.
Jeff Cork.
I was thinking Joe Juba myself. You got a good beard, Joe.
I got a good one going right now, yeah.
Are they different every time?
Yeah, a little bit.
Different every day.
For me, it's Fusoya, Final Fantasy IV.
Is that the old guy?
Yeah, it's the super old guy you meet on the moon, and like when he dies, he basically just turns into a puddle of beard with a little head poking out. It's fantastic.
So the puddle has the best beard in gaming, is what Joe's getting at.
I like Max Payne's beard from Max Payne 3.
Oh, yeah, that game really came out. Beard. Yeah.
If you want to really like, mustache don't count as beard, right?
No.
Okay.
Frankly, I'm insulted to even ask that.
I was asking for Surreal.
Okay.
Yeah.
Surreal, what the hell, dude?
Sorry, guys. I really boned that one.
Surreal has a beard.
Does it?
Wait, does goatee count as a beard?
Goatee's not a beard.
Hey, I think if it's under your lip, it's a beard.
That's absurd. Like a little
Savor flavor?
Yeah, what about the Savor Baver?
Are you okay?
No. Shane in New Hampshire writes in. He says, it's an accepted fact that Leo is the best addition to a team since Ben Linus joined the cast of Lost. I assume that's a compliment, Leo in the booth, so congratulations.
Yeah, he was a real piece of crap, though. So.
But who do you think is the best late addition to a video game series? I'm talking about a regular character in a series who does not appear in the original game. For example, Morden in Mass Effect, Leon in Resident Evil, Raiden in Metal Gear, Chun-Li in Street Fighter, Hawk in Dragon Age 2. Just kidding, Shane says. What do you guys think? Greatest addition.
Oh, that guy.
So should we establish some rules as an ongoing series? Something like Ezio from Assassin's Creed, does he count?
But if the gimmick, not a gimmick, but the feature of the series is constantly rotating protagonists, I think it counts less.
That's what I'm asking. Or Final Fantasy, we can't count those.
No. I think something that could go terribly wrong when they introduce a new character. I think of, maybe Sam Drake, Could have been a disaster.
I was going to mention him.
Yeah, ended up liking him a fair amount.
A bold move to introduce a character that late into the series who nobody had ever talked about and would have been that close to the main character.
Yeah.
But it worked.
So close to Poochie.
Yeah, that's exactly what I was going to bring up. I think my example would probably be Cassie Cage from Mortal Kombat X.
Okay.
She's because when I went into Mortal Kombat X, it felt like, okay, well, I wonder how they're going to make Scorpion and Sub-Zero look this time. But like they added enough new characters that it felt like a very different game. And I think Cassie Cage was probably my favorite of those new additions. And she was like, she ended up being a character I played more than any other, like in that specific game, when I just thought like, well, I guess I'll check in on Scorpion and see how he's doing. And I ended up
doing pretty well, sir.
I'm still dead. But she ended up like monopolizing most of my time with that game, which is fun to see in a series that I've played, you know, for years and years, to have this new source of excitement.
It's funny to think of her in particular because she's voiced by Ashley Birch, who then also voiced Chun-Li in Marvel vs. Capcom Infinite. She really makes the rounds of the greatest hits.
I don't know. I'm toying around with a couple of them. One of them I think is Raiden is the easy sort of example, I think, from MGS2, but I don't think he's that good.
No.
I think
even when they're swinging so hard to try and make him
cool. Yeah, I think the boss from MGS3 being how important that character ends up being to the overall sort of series arc, being introduced that late, I think that's interesting. Another one, given that we were talking about Mega Man earlier, it kind of bends depending on whether or not you count X and Mega Man as different series, but I think like Zero really took off.
Yeah.
He was in Mega Man X, but I mean like 4. I mean, you basically are introducing like a second major Mega Man protagonist that I think turned out really well.
Yeah. So. Space in 7 I thought was pretty cool as well.
Yeah.
Oh, that's a good example there. That's probably better.
Yeah. Jamie from Wisconsin says, hey, crew, on the recent topics of music and games, what moment or scene in a game do you think the music that accompanied it made it a special moment, almost in a way that elevated the moment with its perfect tone? Thanks. Keep up the good work. Scene in a game that was greatly elevated by the music.
Yeah. The obvious one that I always go back to is the Red Dead Redemption when you're crossing over to Mexico.
Yeah.
I feel like that's the easy one for me.
Yeah. There's we talked about on the podcast a while ago when we just broke down some of our favorite game music. Cork brought it up. But the ending of Lego City Undercover, you are jumping out of like a space station and skydiving all the way back to Earth. And it's just the most epic music that builds. And it's like this choral chant of people going, Lego, Lego. It's awesome.
That is fantastic.
And it's really, I think it holds true to this question from Jamie specifically, because they have done that like free falling mechanic in so many Lego games after. And it's just kind of like, okay, I guess I'll go through some rings, blah, 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 blah. But when you have like this choral chant and it's this epic tone underneath, it's amazing.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, so I've got Metal Gear Solid 3 on the brain. I think the ladder scene.
Okay. If there was no music, it would just be like, what the hell?
Yeah, it would just be you're just climbing up a dumb ladder. But now, like because there's that song there, people think about that as, like, you know, the ladder.
Was that designed like with a stupid long ladder for like loading reasons, and then they're like, let's add a song to it? Or did he have this idea of like, I want them to climb up a ladder and there's a song? What do you think?
I'm not a huge James Bond guy. I think you are, Joe.
Yeah.
I mean, the entire opening, the Snake Eater theme, that's just like a huge homage to
Bond. Oh, yeah.
Right?
That's absolutely
okay.
Like a James Bond
movies, like 3/4 of the way through, do they usually like harken back to the main theme at some point? Or is there any like template for that reminder?
I don't think that's like a formulaic beat
of
the series, no.
So which came first then?
I think he had the idea.
Yeah.
That's what I would guess.
It seems to me like he wanted to highlight that cool song in a sort of quiet moment. I think that works.
I bet there was a moment where he's talking to a designer. He's like, make the ladder longer. And then he came back 2 days later. No, longer.
You think I'm joking around?
Like three times. He's like, keep making this longer. And the guy's like, made it stupid long. He's like, yeah.
You know what?
Now double it.
We could also just be adding like some sort of element of artistic intent behind that. That's really like, wow, we got a long ass load coming up that we just make ladder huge. It's like, wow, that's really boring. How can we fill in this long load time that's happening behind the scenes?
Plus, you got to think of, I would imagine that song came pretty late in the process, like long after like levels were laid out in rough, you know, white box areas. I would theorize, you know? And so I wonder if it's a thing of like, this song's so good, we got to find some spot in the game. Oh, this one here, if we just stretch this part out, plug it in.
The temp music they used for that was the Hey Mikey, He Likes It. Just a little known fact. Yeah.
I also feel like I would be dropping the ball if I did not take this opportunity to point out the ending of Saints Row the Third, that final sequence where Holding Out for a Hero plays.
Yeah, there's a lot of good
which
music,
like I was literally
series.
Pumping my fist in the air as I was doing that.
That is the dorkiest thing I've ever heard on this Game Informer podcast.
That was so awesome. Okay.
Jordan says, hey, Jordan Bay is here. wishing you all a happy holidays.
Thanks, Jordan.
Thanks, Jordan. Not aging is a big trope in media. Yeah, mm-hmm. He's right. But if you suddenly stopped aging right now, how long would it realistically take you to realize you aren't aging anymore?
Oh, wow.
Wow. Okay.
Interesting question.
Okay.
So the question I have...
15 years.
Okay, but aging, does that mean hair growth?
No, your hair would still grow normally and stuff.
Does it really?
Yeah, I mean, otherwise you'd notice like, oh, wow, I haven't had to shave in a week. That's weird. I'm aging. Okay. Or I'm not. No, I think aging is the process of like, you know, you're...
Dying.
Like, I don't know, like skin deterioration and your innards getting worse.
Slow down.
Hold on. So would your skin stop like growing and falling off?
Just inflating? What are you talking about?
I don't
about?
Know if you got cut. Would you heal?
I think so.
Yeah, healing isn't aging, man.
For the last time, healing ain't aging.
You don't have to say like, "Whoa, I got cut. I have to wait for that to age up."
Well, no, but like,
well, I think it's all about your cells dividing. Right. It is all a result of your metabolism.
No, okay, but that's why you can't cut an old person. Reeves is right.
You guys have you tried to stab an old person?
You guys are getting way too biology about this. You know,
pretend it's a superpower.
In general, that it's like, okay, I just don't age anymore.
I think it could easily take years.
I think it would take 100 years before I noticed.
You're taking your wife being buried.
Someone would have to tell me of like, it's been, you know, however many years and you look exactly the same.
No one would ever tell you that though.
I think eventually people would, because you'll start to see, you know, like if you go back and visit family like every once in a while, you'll start to see them age. And I think at some point they'll notice like you look exactly the same.
I don't think they would.
Your son totally looks older than you do.
I think you would just take it as a compliment for the first two holidays you spent over there. Also, I think
that's what I'm saying. It would still take years, but yeah. I'm saying the moment I found out, someone would have to tell me.
Yeah, I give myself no undue credit on this. Like I think it would probably take me 15 years.
Because you look like an old person?
Yeah.
Exactly. Well, yeah, you got like minimalist features or like clear, distinct
minimalist
features.
Minimalist features. Yeah. I look at you and I'm just see a generic man.
Yeah, you're like a me before I've chosen any options for the face.
I'm default on the character creator.
Default human.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah.
And I think the other thing would be like going back and looking at old pictures like, oh, this is from like Facebook from like 10 years ago and you look exactly the same.
Sure. Like, do you think Steve Martin ever wonders if the last 30 years or 40 years this has been an aspect of his life?
Nelson's
a skeleton.
Yeah, before he passed away. Before he really aged now.
Yeah, before his skeleton farted its last part.
I wonder if okay, so like part of the question is, does your hair keep growing or not? But also like, I wonder if your hairline, like that's part of aging, right? Your hairline receding?
Yes. Yeah.
So they wouldn't recede.
But like, I wouldn't notice that either, really.
Yeah, Lord knows you wouldn't.
Yeah, so. you're already past that point of no return.
Yeah.
God, you know, the comedian John Mulaney once put it best, where he's like, oh, I always expected at some point I was going to grow up and look like an adult. Turns out aging doesn't mean you like look older and more sophisticated. It just means you look worse each year. I always think of that. That's all aging is at a certain point you realize.
I always used to want to play as like young hip characters, like me. I but as I've gotten more mature, I do kind of like appreciate playing as an old guy, like Old Snake. That was kind of fun to play as like a guy who's like old and like struggling with like being an old person. And I kind of wish there was more representation of that in video games. I think that might actually be a healthy thing for our culture.
If there's more respecting your elders?
Well, just like, how do you deal with becoming an old person and like your body is starting to fall apart?
You turn into a sniper like Anna does in Overwatch.
Yeah, exactly.
I actually really like trying to create older characters when they give me the option and like, you know, character creators and stuff. But then you run into weird things like all of your friends are 17 and you're like 70. And then it's like, oh, that's weird.
Also, lighting on wrinkles is kind of a rough thing.
Yeah, developers still haven't really figured out how to like make that slider, the age slider just is not right.
That's the only reason they do it?
Yeah, well, anyway.
Specifically, I think it's fun if we give him an exact amount of time. I think for me, it would be 6 years.
15 really? Years.
15!
Yeah.
I think it would probably take about 5 or 6 years,
I think 15 sounds about right.
For you?
I don't know.
You're a young-looking dude. Like, we're not going to out you here, but you're old as sin.
Yeah.
And people would guess, like, 10 years younger, I think, than you actually are.
That happens.
Do the math, people.
I don't have it anymore, but I used to get, like, oh, what grade are you in? A lot.
Like a couple years ago?
Well, when I was in high school, yeah.
Oh, okay.
When was the last time? How long ago was the last time you got carded?
Well, I mean, you still get carded for things, right? That's not uncommon. I don't get carded all the time, but I still get carded sometimes.
Yeah.
A month ago.
Hey, there we go. Favorite email of the week, by the way.
I like that last one.
Aging?
Can we give it to the universe for having Surreal eat Surreal?
Oh, sure. I don't know. If,
ship it out to
I
the
think,
universe?
We is don't ship outside of the United States.
I mean,
the
but the United
mostly...
States is part of the universe.
That's so, you know, Surreal has a good point. I think we might have to give this one to the universe, you guys.
This one's for you, universe.
I like that our game's getting too complicated. Simple concept one.
The
I like
music
the
one was good.
The aging one I like.
And the aging one.
Yeah, I think we got to go aging, right?
Yeah, I like that question.
Yeah. All right, Jordan, congratulations. We'll ship you out something really nice. Probably the nicest thing you've ever seen. Oh, also, it's a package deal this time. We're going to give you the gift of immortality. It's a real Fountain of Youth.
Congrats.
So,
it's also a curse, by the way. Don't worry about it.
But. Yeah, oh, yeah, it's terrible. Yeah, you don't
you'll discover.
It.
And when it's bestowed on you is a mystery. So how long is it going to take you to figure out?
That you're immortal?
Yeah.
You tell us.
Cuts no longer heal. Yeah. Well, I'm sorry.
Hi, GI crew. I fell off a building today and didn't die.
Hey, Jordan. Good to hear.
But my legs are still broken. Help.
Oh, no. All right. That's
SOS.
You're immortal, but you still can get gravely wounded.
I was gravely wounded. My first instinct was to email a podcast for help.
Thank God I had the messenger app on my phone.
Here's the address.
Hey, thanks for guys.
We're going to ship you out something real nice.
Once a week, we check our messages and maybe help someone.
Speaking of ageless, Dauntless, everybody. Who wants to learn more about Dauntless? It's a fun chat with Ian and Nick from Phoenix Labs, and it's a full interview. Stay tuned for the back half of this interview, by the way, for a fun Mass Effect 3 story. So without further ado, here's Ian and Nick. And welcome back to the Informer Show. I'm still here. I'm still Ben Hansen. I'm joined by Nick Clifford from Phoenix Labs.
Yep. Nice.
Welcome. Sir, you're working on Dauntless, right?
Yep.
Great. And we also have Ian Tornay.
Yes, sir.
All right. Fantastic. Community man working on Dauntless.
By trade.
You guys are actually in the office. People listening to this might be shocked by the audio quality here. What are you doing here? What are you showing off?
Well, we just wandered in because we heard there were really cool game statues and an extensive video game collection.
Yeah. We got a lot of people wandering in off the street that way.
Yeah. But we accidentally also brought a video game to demo for you guys.
Oh, fantastic.
Yeah, so we did that, played around. And so our game is Dauntless, online co-op action RPG, coming to PC. And we're working on a really big update that brings a lot of new exciting stuff and came to show it off to you guys.
So how does this work? So there's a big update, but the game is in what state right now? Can people play it if they want to on PC?
Yeah, so right now Dauntless is in closed beta. We launched our closed beta back in August. We've been in this early access period ever since. And right now we're launching our largest content update to date. It includes new weapon, new behemoths, new encounters, new combat features, kind of from the ground up a massive overhaul of the game. We've been listening to the community since we launched back in August, even before that when we were in technical alpha, and just trying to build the best game that we possibly can. Their feedback was really instrumental in that process. And this is kind of the first step in many in that evolution of Dauntless.
Do you guys have a fancy, splashy name for this expansion? You need something like the Lightning Expansion or something cool like that?
Sharpen your skills.
Oh, good. Come on, Mark.
Yeah, that's good. Ian's the voice. I'm just here.
You're just the
I'm
you're
the
looks.
Tag along.
You're
yeah.
The looks. Yeah.
No, that is a stretch.
Well, you know, we're an independent studio. We'll get there.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, Sharpen Your Skills is what it's called. Our game is all about fighting gigantic monsters called behemoths. We really like to lean into challenging games. A lot of us are big Dark Souls fans. A lot of us are big Monster Hunter fans. And so, you know, whenever we put something out, it's not just like, all right, here's something for you to come face roll. It really is, okay, here's something that's going to push your skills. Here's something that's going to challenge you. And that's what we hear people like. That's what we like. And so that's what we're doing.
Yeah. Okay. So you guys must get this in every interview you do, but so many people must bring up, oh, it's just like a cool indie Monster Hunter type game.
Sure, I'll take that, yeah.
You guys are open to that obvious connection?
Yeah, we're huge Monster Hunter fans.
Yeah?
Yeah, I mean, I think between the office, we've got thousands of hours played in Monster Hunter. But beyond that, we've drawn inspiration from some of our favorite games over the years, Dark Souls, as Ian mentioned. Even more modern games like Destiny and World of Warcraft, and how they've kind of blazed a trail in online social gaming space. So I think, there are some comparisons to Monster Hunter to be had, but overall, like, we just wanted to build a fun co-op game where you'd feel like a badass with your friends, having fun, sharing like these really cool water cooler moments of achievement, taking down big behemoth, feeling awesome while you do it.
Yeah, feeling awesome at all times. Yeah. So say like we have... listeners or viewers that are Monster Hunter fans, they check out Dauntless. What's going to be shockingly different? What are the first cues that like, oh, this is why this is a new experience?
Yeah, I think, I mean, we talk about this a lot. We're all huge Japanese game fans. Like when we were up in the vault, you know, we geeked out over the Dreamcast section. We're talking about how much we'd love a new Suikoden game. Love Japanese games. I miss weird Japanese games. The Dreamcast was definitely my favorite thing. Like
favorite console of all time?
I would say favorite console of all time.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, it's a tough pull, but I'll go there.
PSO, you're one of those guys?
Yeah, I do the I had the keyboard. I made my dad buy me that like gigantic keyboard. And with my little Dreamcast backpack character. It was great. That's a great game. And then I had my like Dreamcast. Anyway,
did you also have a Rob growing up too?
I did not have the Rob, but okay. I did have the Power Glove. It was so bad.
I still think that makes you spoiled.
So bad.
To the core. I'm an awful human being, but it hasn't stopped. But yeah, I think Dauntless started off as a sequel to Pepsi Man, and then we just slowly gravitated towards the monster hunting genre.
Okay, accidentally,
yeah.
I understand.
Yeah, so, I mean, to be serious, like, we do love Japanese games. There is a lot, I think, the way that Japanese games are developed and the development process for Japanese games is approached is one of tradition and observing kind of, like, what's come before. Of course, we honor that, and I think you can't move forward without looking back. We're really proud of the pedigree in our studio. We have a lot of people from Riot. We have a lot of people from BioWare. We have people from Blizzard. We have people from Capcom. But what we're bringing to the table is a clean slate. So looking at all the features, looking at all the things in a traditional RPG and a monster hunting game, and that includes everything. I mean, in part, I think PSO actually blazed the trail for games like that. But you can look at God Eater. You can look at Tokiden. And I think you see a lot of features that made a lot of sense for certain platforms or for a certain time, and maybe haven't aged as well. And since we're starting from scratch, we can say, okay, what is gaming in 2017, 2018, and what are the best things from co-op experiences that we can bring to the game? And that's what we do.
Is it an oversimplification to say kind of like, let's smooth down some of those rough edges, maybe clean some systems up? Is that the overall philosophy for Dauntless?
I think
so too.
It's in there, yeah.
Yeah, I think... we definitely have tried to clean up a lot of the cruft in some of the more traditionally designed games of the past.
Cruft, that's a good word.
If I can put it as politically correct as possible. But again, like we've also learned from games like Destiny, Warframe, like stuff that's kind of completely outside our genre space, just in terms of like how they've helped improve online gaming and online social gaming.
Yeah.
Yeah. So the big overhaul, what did you guys learn from the community? What do you think that they wanted? Maybe that was surprising based on when you initially launched?
Yeah, I would say, part of it was paring things down. And there were parts that we learned. Games are weird. Games are fun. Like some of the best parts about games, some of my fondest memories of games are things that are more complicated that aren't pared down. It's like, yeah, of course I spent 40 hours racing chocobos to get Knights of the Round. Like, what else are you going to do with your weekend? And so... of course, you're going to get the quad summon too, so you can just really one-hit Sephiroth. But
naturally.
Yeah, what are you going to do? You're a spoiled, lonely kid. And but at any rate, I think like there were some systems that we'd pared down too far that maybe would streamline too much.
Oh, interesting.
So we added back some sophistication to some combat. We added some sophistication in the form of a socketing system, which we call cells. The other thing, too, is that when we were a free-to-play game, and when we came out, it was like, okay, well, how are we going to make money? Because we unfortunately have to eat because I'm spoiled. And I'm not going to let that go.
And you only eat Dreamcast keyboards.
Yes. Until you get me a new one and then I'm not leaving. I'm setting up shop here. Anyway, I think, one of the things that we did is was like, okay, so you can buy loot boxes. You can just go in and buy a loot box, crack it open. It's got cosmetics in it. Happy. Because we're firmly against pay to win. We're firmly against pay to power. So it's all about cosmetics. I was like, loot boxes. That's how everyone does it. That's how we did it. That's how Dad did it. Everyone's going to be happy. We heard very early on that it wasn't great. It wasn't what people wanted. So we decided to take them out.
Just and then, overall, people are like, loot boxes and this type of game, it feels gross.
Well, and it was
more about people spending money and getting a chance at a reward.
Yeah.
And again, like Ian mentioned, it was kind of not necessarily commonplace, but pretty practically used throughout the industry. So we defaulted to it when we went with our free-to-play model. And we got a lot of feedback early on. It was just like, hey, man, I dropped $5 and I got the dance that I don't like. I want the dance that I like. And we're like, oh, man, that feels really bad. How can we address that? How can we fix that?
Yeah, because for us, part of the reason we went free to play is that, you know, we all grew up playing games where it's like you buy the game, you read the review, you're like, okay, it feels pretty good. And you buy the game, $60, and then if you like it, you're set. If you don't like it, you're in a really rough place. And one of the great things about free to play for us is that we will only succeed if we're doing the right thing for our players. We're only going to succeed. We're only going to make money. We're only going to thrive if we're doing the right thing and we're making players happy. And that's a relationship that pushes us artistically and creatively, and it keeps us honest and earnest. And so we heard back, like, oh, the loot box thing doesn't make me feel great. It's like, I'll do it, but I don't love it. So we endeavored to change it. And then what site was that on? All of them. there was a little kerfuffle about loot boxes. And, you know, it's gratifying to see that we were doing the right thing and we're doing the right thing for games. And I think that's something as a studio we always want to do. You know, all of us came from pretty big studio backgrounds. We could have stayed there if we wanted, but we chose to do our own thing.
So what is it now? How did you guys rework everything?
Yeah, so now you're like, I want that emote, or I want that die, or I want, it's a great, buy it. It's yours, done. Yeah.
It's more of a like a direct purchasing model now where you just go into the store, you find what you want, you buy it, you don't have to pull the slot machine and hope that you get it.
Yeah.
That's the amazing part. I'm still trying to figure out Phoenix Labs in general, like all these amazing developers getting together.
Mm-hmm.
Who's funding this? Where's the money coming from?
I knew we forgot money.
How is everybody getting together? What made everybody leave giant publishers to go? Is it just passion of making a game in the vein of Monster Hunter?
Yeah. So I think the average tenure of our studio is at least like 10 years, maybe.
Years,
yeah. So we've all been around the block a couple times, whether it's BioWare, EA, Capcom, Blizzard, Riot. Most recently, many of us came from Riot Games, where we worked on League of Legends for many years. Had an awesome time doing it. And we wanted to get back to making games for ourselves. So Jesse, Robin, Sean, who were all at Riot at the time, left Riot Games, founded the company. Fortunately, League of Legends made a little bit of money while we were there. So we went to a lot of the people who we had connections with already and talked to them about starting our own studio and basically wanting to do it again, wanted to get back into making a new game. So we're privately backed. We're super fortunate in that respect that we secured money very early on to pay for the development of Dauntlesss.
And when you're pitching this to potential, you know, funders of the overall project, are you talking about genre? Are you talking about game mechanics? Or is it just, hey, you guys like League of Legends, right? What if we made a new game?
It's funny you mentioned that, because the first time that we started pitching investors, we didn't really have a game idea in mind. It was just it's the guy who ran League, the guy who ran development of League, and the guy who was head of people on League are going to start a company. And people are like, go on, what can you tell us?
So
we secured our initial funding without a genre in mind.
That's amazing. Just off the strength.
Well, you really, I mean, success. Making games is hard. It is a ton of work. And I think more and more people are, I mean, games are getting harder and harder to make. And you are seeing that reflected with these huge studios, right? Where it's like, look, if you want to make a blockbuster, it's going to take 500 people. It's going to take a, you know, super huge marketing budget to make that money back. And that's not without a cost to morale. That's not without a cost to, you know, something's got to give somewhere, right? And so for us, I think it's less about when you know that you want to make games for a living. You, like, any of us could go, well, not any of us, because I can't program, but anyone working in games could probably make 2, 3, 4 times as much money making tax software.
Interesting.
Like, yeah. And it would be a way better bet. You'd definitely get your holidays. You'd get way more paid leave.
It's a cool co-op experience.
It's all right. You know, spreadsheets are, you know, the new version of Eve. Microsoft Excel 2018 is really coming together. And, you know, we could do that. So you make games because you're passionate about it. And you know that you're going to be in the office early and you're going to be there late. And you're going to work weekends. You're probably going to work holidays. And so you got to know that you're going to love working with the people you work with. So when I got the call from Nick, it wasn't, hey, we're making this game. Hey, we're doing this. It was like, well, I like Nick. I would love to work with these guys. Let's go do it. What are you making? Okay, yep, that sounds great. Let's do it. And that makes all the difference. And that was a very early rule for the studio, was in order to get hired, you needed to know someone that worked there. You couldn't
Oh, interesting.
Yeah, so we all know each other by 2 or 3 degrees of separation, and it makes all the difference because you know you can trust the guy working next to you. You know if you got to work late that you're going to have a great time. Like anyone from the studio could be sitting here next to me. I could be anyone else from the studio, and we would trust each other implicitly, and we would be having a great – like when we travel, we have a great time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Do you think, I mean, do other studios do that? Is that pretty rare to have that weird, you need to know somebody to get in the door here?
Yeah, it's less about the nepotism and more job interviews are so weird. Yeah. Like, it's so hard to suss out whether you're going to have, you know, years, decades of a good time working with somebody through an hour of talking with them.
Right.
So for us, it was more like, hey, I worked with Jesse on the Mass Effect trilogy. I worked with him at Riot Games. When he thought about someone to help with publishing, he's like, well, I know Nick the best. I know what he's capable of. I've seen him publish a box product. I've seen him publish an online game. Let's go there. And then same thing when we started thinking about community, I was like, okay, who's the best community person
who's
I know?
Who's got the keyboard?
Who's got, yeah. Who had a power glove growing up? It's Ian, naturally. Yeah, so it's been great for us. We've been super fortunate in that we're really working with some of our best friends and some of the, like, yeah. I mean, like, some of the smartest people I've ever worked with. Like, I learn something new every day when I go into the office. It's awesome.
Yeah.
And so, I don't know if you guys were there, but was it just a process of, okay, we have some money, we can run the studio for a little while, and then we have a just completely empty whiteboard. Let's start writing down genres. Let's start writing down concepts we like.
You are not too far off from the truth. Like, okay. When we thought about our first game, we actually storyboarded out or whiteboarded out a couple different genres. The second place, not many people know this, but second place was a character-based shooter long before Overwatch, Paladins,
yeah.
Battleborn, and Paragon, and all yeah. came out. So we fortunately dodged that bullet, but... we knew kind of at the core, we always wanted to make a social experience for yeah. players. We wanted people to play together, have fun together, and build relationships yeah. together.
It really starts from, okay, in the last 4 or 5 years, what were your favorite moments in gaming?
Where I whooped your ass at Marvel.
Wow.
You guys are big Marvel guys?
Excuse me for a moment. How's it going over there?
Pretty good.
Yeah, we have a very competitive fighting game little club inside the studio. So
that's cool.
I'm an MVC2 guy. I am awful at MVCI, so Nick's been repaving me. But when the new Chaos Code comes out, I think you're going to be a little bit of trouble.
Yeah.
I'm excited.
As a side note, I've never heard anybody in the industry be like, I'm super in MVCI. So that's cool. It's nice to know that someone's playing that game out
yeah,
there.
It's yeah, it's a good game. Yeah. It's a good game. I just suck at it. So, yeah. You know, I'm excited for the quadruple HD overhaul of MVC2. Heard it here first. I have no power to confirm that, but I think if I just, like, say it's happening, it can happen, right?
Yeah, just ask your dad.
Yeah, just
ask.
Yeah.
From the man that brought you Power Glove.
Yeah. For one dude.
Comes super cheap Magneto combos.
Sorry, so favorite gaming moments of the past
couple
years.
Yeah. And so, you know, I think gaming has, it's weird when people say, oh, gaming's changed, because I gaming has grown so quickly that I don't even know if you could ever point at a point in time when gaming has been stagnant, except for maybe like the early years of arcades. And, but gaming has definitely become more social. And I think what's interesting is we're starting to see things where it doesn't even really matter what the game is. It's about playing with your friends, and the game is kind of a conceit to hang out. Part of that is us just getting older and having jobs and stuff. You know, it's like, what is everyone playing? I'm playing dr. Oh, okay. Sure, I'll play that. Why? Well, because everyone else isn't. It'll be fun, right? And so what we were like is like, well, there are these amazing social moments. We love playing with our friends. And we also saw kind of the re-advent of challenging games, of the Souls franchise, of, I mean, Nick's a fighting game guy. That's a tough as nails genre. And we knew that we wanted to make something challenging, something that made you feel rewarded. And you even start to look at other media where you go, okay, so what are our favorite movies? What's your favorite moment in a movie? What gives you that visceral rush? And there's a lot of moments, and I think you see this a ton in trailers, because trailers try to encapsulate this, is, you know, you're just one dude standing against impossible odds, and there's nowhere else you'd rather
be. And then the monster roars and it cuts to black.
Yeah, exactly. Cuts to black. And then, okay. Whoa.
Yeah.
Yep.
That's my favorite movie
and then
moment.
You fade back up, and I've got the glove on. And, so standing against impossible odds and knowing that there's nowhere else you'd rather be, an amazing social experience, and making games with your best friends. What could be better? And that's really where we started. And then we were just saying, okay, what are we playing? What's going on? And we're playing a few different games, and you start monkeying around, and we ended up where we ended up.
That's awesome. And I mean, also as a matter of like, oh, outside of Monster Hunter, no one has really nailed this.
Oh,
and
sure.
Sorry to, I know it's beyond
yeah.
Monster
no,
Hunter.
No, 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 but yeah. I mean, analogy. Yeah.
And I mean, that was a large part of it early on is we were all playing a ton of Monster Hunter. And at the time, obviously, Monster Hunter Worlds hadn't been announced, but we were really craving an HD action hunting experience.
Yeah.
You know, and we had God Eater, which I think I'm the only one in the studio who plays it. Tokiden, which I played a little bit of that as well. Still no one else really played it. And it was really hard for me to pull my friends into those franchises because there's just, again, not that, you know, I want to throw them under the bus, but there's just like a lot of cruft and unknowable systems built into those games. Yeah. And we looked at Monster Hunter and we looked at a ton of other games in the action hunting space. And we wanted to make a game that we could play with our friends. Like I could tell Ian, like, hey, play Dauntless. And he'd be like, oh, okay, sounds cool. And he wouldn't bounce off in, you know, the 10-hour tutorial where he's picking up dinosaur poop for three missions.
Right.
Yeah.
I like picking through dinosaur poop. I don't know what's wrong with you, man.
I don't. Well, I'm allergic, unfortunately. Mm. Yeah.
Hey, here's a dumb one-off. I follow a lot of Double Fine stuff.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Did you guys ever follow Brazen? It was a Monster Hunter-like game that they were trying to pitch to publishers and it was roundly rejected, at least the storyline goes.
Yeah.
And then that eventually led to Massive Chalice, I believe.
Yes, which I like Massive Chalice. I'm a big XCOM guy, so Massive Chalice was right up my alley.
Oh, right on. It's just interesting, just coming from a Double Fine perspective, and mostly because of the videos they release are amazing.
Yeah.
But just seeing that like Brazen could be rejected by publishers, and then it's like, hey, here's another Monster Hunter game, and it's like, cool, League of Legends backing, we got it.
Well, I mean, and the weird thing too, right, is that I don't think the Double Fine story is dissimilar from our own. I think Tim's put together a studio of people that he really likes, that they all love making games together. And again, you know, a lot of these guys, if they weren't making tax software, could go down to Ubi, they could go to EA, they could go to Sony in the Bay. They could go to Zynga. They could go anywhere and be making a ton of money and get in at 10 and leave at 4 and be in a cafeteria that was cooler than any theme park you'd ever been in. But they want to make games together. And so they make games together. And there's a lot to be said for that. As far as why, you know, some games hit the thing and they get accepted and sometimes they don't. I've been in pitches and meetings. I mean, when we were at EA, like you would see what's coming down the pipe and sometimes be like, oh, this is going to be awesome. There's no way. And then like 2 years later, like, yeah, I don't know what we're thinking. And sometimes you see something where it's like, did you get under the sink and drink that stuff again? And it's like, no, but then it turns into an amazing game.
Yeah.
And, you know, I think part of it is when you move away from the huge, and again, this is not an indictment of the system, but when you move away from the huge AAA game production system and you move away from, okay, every quarter, we got to be throwing up numbers every year. We got to make the stockholders happy too. Look, we are 100% beholden to our fans. We're 100% beholden to our founders, and we're 100% beholden to our investors. But when you come in with the expectation of we're doing this for the right reasons, it gives you a flexibility that I think, you know, maybe wasn't the right situation for Brazen. I mean, there are so many factors, it's impossible to say.
Yeah, definitely. How's everything going for you guys? How's the studio doing overall?
Pretty great.
Yeah, really great. I mean, it was a pretty seminal moment when we launched the closed beta back in August. I mean, we launched the closed beta and went to PAX in the same weekend, which was lunacy. And we shipped a trailer, which was also lunacy.
Yep. Right after Thanksgiving.
Yeah. It was pretty ambitious, but it was really cool to see everyone come into the game, have fun playing it. Like, we kind of watched like our CCU numbers, like the chart in the office is, it's kind of like what was the name of the thing from 24, the control room?
Oh yeah.
So we like see like the CCU numbers just kind of like going up, and it was like it's happening, like the dream is real. People are playing the game, logging in, having fun. And well, I mean, it's a really cool moment when you can jump in and play your game with the community. Like, I know it sounds
under the radar, or
well, no, it just seems like something so obvious, but like, I mean, we started building this game 3 years ago, and like we're now at a point where like it's out there, people are playing it, and like you can log in and like play with the community and hear what they say and like hear their genuine excitement or hear their critical feedback and like actually do something with it. Like,
Cause
it's really cool.
Cause I think maybe what, like any game, you're talking about at least 3 years of development you're like, yep, this is definitely the game we're making. And then you're talking about probably another year or two of, okay, we've got squares bumping off of each other, to another year, 2 years of, okay, now it's a video game. And it's a very different mindset. Pre-production, production, post-production is an extremely different mindset when you're making a game. And so that first moment where someone plays your game, you're like, oh, it's real. Okay, this is real. It is surreal.
Are you guys just watching Twitch streams, just like trying to see inner reaction? Yeah. Like, I think they smiled there. I don't know what that means.
It's excruciating. I mean, it's exciting. And then we have these big screens up in the office, and Lyric decides to play, which is both great and awful because it's like, well, here comes 30,000 people to form an opinion about our game.
Here comes 30,000 people onto our servers built for a fraction of that.
And the server goes down. And he's like, oh, I think the server is down. It's like, red alert! Everyone, go! And we rush, we skyline. I'm talking to him on Twitter. And he's a very patient guy, so he's very sweet. But
Tangent, don't forget where you're going. When the server goes down, what do? You go and you plug in more servers? What does that look like inside of a studio when the servers are just cannot support this?
Yeah, so red lights come on.
Again, going back to learning something new every day, I thought servers were just like a rack that lived inside of a cellar somewhere.
Right.
That's my antiquated thinking of things. But very much to the credit of our engineering team, we use a combination of like cloud storage and Amazon and Google servers to kind of have everything live in the cloud, so to speak. Yeah. But what that means is like it's very easy for us to spin up additional cores and additional servers for our game. Takes, you know, as long as it takes someone at Amazon to walk over and flip a switch. So 5-10 minutes.
Yeah.
Okay. So servers go down. Like literally, you get on the phone with Amazon.
Yeah,
and
we're like,
and you say, hey, give us more cloud.
And he's like, oh, that's why the rack's belching flame. Yeah, we'll get on top of that. And then they spin them up, they spin up more servers. And it's not worth going into the details, but it is just basically like it's a power bill. I think this is interesting when people talk about like, well, how the hell did they not know how many, like when a multiplayer game launches and it goes down.
Exactly.
It's hard to believe this, but electricity is a big deal. It's very expensive. And heat is a big deal. It's very expensive to cool these things. And so when people are like, well, how did they not anticipate this many? Well, it's like you project, you guess. But what happens is that if you spin up too many servers, you are hemorrhaging money. It is extremely expensive to spin up extra servers ahead of time. I know people won't believe me, but too bad. It's the truth. And so you're ideally going, we had this many servers, we had this many people, and you go like this forever, right?
Right. Right.
I think it's to be expected that, you know, you go here and it comes here and then you go, and you figure it out. It's fine. And that's what happens. So you make the call, you get on the horn with the guy and the guy's like, okay, well, what are you anticipating? Are you going up? Are you coming down? Where are we going? And then you just over time. Now we're lucky. I mean, with Amazon and Google, they are so good at it. Like, I'm sure they're using machine learning to actually predict what the ebb and flow is. And
so you just call up the sentient AI.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. You just,
hello,
you just,
Skynet,
you go,
we need more games.
Dear Mr. Zuckerberg, would you please bless us with, and it happens. Yeah. If you just put out your iPhone and you talk about it, you're like, I wish our servers would come back up.
A lot of people are complaining on Twitter.
Yeah. As long as you have the Facebook app installed, weird things happen.
No, but talking about just seeing the numbers go up on Steam or not on Steam, but just overall.
Yeah.
I mean, what's moving the needle for you guys? What do you think have been the keys to success? I mean, coming from a marketing background, what have been the big splashes along the way?
It's a good question. I think it's been really, for me, I think we've kind of leveraged a combination of things. There hasn't been that like one seminal moment where we're like, and we did it. We have been fighting tooth and nail, and everyone has been putting in like crazy hours and exhausting every opportunity to get our game in front of as many people as possible. So like, we do things like we go to PAX, we're there all day, every day. We then make ourselves available nearby at bars and restaurants to meet players and hear them and hang out with them. We put out trailers constantly. We do develop, like Ian has been writing a developer blog a week, like in perpetuity since the dawn of time.
Wait, am I supposed to be doing that?
Not this week. You got the week off, baby. Don't worry.
That's good.
Ian is always on the forums, as is everyone else back home.
Yeah.
Ian's constantly engaging with people on Twitch, making sure that they have codes to play the game and are hanging out.
We made a very conscious effort not to throw money at people.
Yeah.
When you have a game, the second that you breach water and make yourself known to the world, you get about 1,000 emails from people saying, hey, if you give me $5,000, I'll get you 10,000. If you give me this much money, if you do
I'll
this,
I'll give you access to our influencer network.
Yeah. Oh, come on. And
so,
I'm
going to jump in you keep going, Ian. One of the things that we have not necessarily prided ourselves on, but one of the things that we believe in doing is everyone who's been following Dauntlesss, signed up for an account, it's all been organic. Like, we haven't paid really for anyone. I mean, I know you pay when you go to like PAX and you pay when you make a trailer.
We haven't paid for ads.
Yeah, we haven't paid for ads. Like everyone who signed up for an account, everyone who's playing the game is playing it because they want to, because we had a conversation with them. We did something to impress them. And that's kind of like core to our philosophy is like, everyone at the studio, especially the marketing team, especially me, I hold myself to a really high degree of authenticity and transparency and just being open. Like we don't BS with players. Like we tell them the truth. When they give us critical feedback, we give them an honest response. We admit when we make mistakes. And I think like all of that ladders up to building trust in players and building a relationship with them. And ultimately, like, I mean, if we want to get really gross in marketing theory, like, I think fostering that relationship with the player so that they become an advocate for you and that they believe in you as a person and you as a company, that's way more powerful than any ad I could take out on Google or Facebook any day.
So building that advocate from players, that's an interesting angle because then it's like, okay, now so much of our success hinges on each individual player telling their friends about it and making sure that the on-ramp is okay.
Yeah.
And the tutorial is not going to scare anybody off.
Right. Yep.
Like, how does that then go back and influence design just to make sure that friends,
for sure,
the people that do go out on a limb and try and rope in their friends don't say, what the hell's wrong with you? What is this crap?
Well, and that's a very intentional part of it. That's actually part of the thinking, which is that, look, if you showed up because you're passionate, you're going to give us the feedback we need.
Yeah.
If we are not doing it right, people are not going to stick around. They're not going to show up. And so, like, this update that we're doing would not have been possible at the quality level if we were, you know, just like scraping people in, because when it's like, if you play our game, it doesn't really matter how or why you got there. I appreciate it. And I want to create the best experience for you. But if you came in because you're passionate about the genre or because you have a friend that's passionate about the game or for whatever reason, you're much more likely to give feedback that we can use to make a better game. And I am excited to make those kinds of people a cornerstone of our community. And so, we know, having all of these people having shown up organically, that the feedback they gave us is coming from not a place of like, well, I gave you my money and let's go. It's coming from a place of, I really care about this game, and that you literally cannot pay for feedback like that, and it's invaluable. So it's hugely gratifying, and it's also hugely edifying.
Yeah, definitely. Going back into your guys' history a little bit,
sure.
Were you both at EA? Is that right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
That sounds so excited. Yeah. We, I think I spent, let me think about this, I spent about 6 or 7 years at EA.
Oh, wow.
Started way back in QA on Command & Conquer Generals. What's up?
Awesome.
Made the transition to publishing, which is what I studied at university, and then worked on Mass Effect Trilogy for a bit. That's where I met Ian. He was working on Battlefield at the time, and we all worked on Mass Effect 3 together. And then, transitioned over to Riot Games to work on League for a couple years.
Yeah.
Oh, nice. Wait, so you're working on which Battlefield then?
I started on Battlefield 3, and then I did some work on 4.
Doing what exactly?
I was the community manager. I was the North American publishing community manager.
Oh, awesome.
How many times did you have your dog tags stolen from
you? Oh, dude. Yeah, so this is actually really fun. So we had a dog tag machine that we got for...
Not IRL dog tags, you nerd. How many times did you get stabbed in game?
Well, that was the thing. So we had an IRL dog tag machine that we bought for this conference. And then someone up top figured out that we'd spend like $50,000 on it. I was like, oh, but you're going to get value out of this machine or you're in trouble. I was like, okay, sorry. So I had it in my cube and I had this little game where it was like, if you stab, because in Battlefield, when someone stabs you in the game, they stab you, they grab your tags, they twist and they pull the tags off.
Sure.
And so it was like, if you find Ian in the game and you stab him and take his tags in the game, I will actually physically mail you real dog tags.
That's amazing.
So everyone else played Battlefield. I played this really weird Left 4 Dead expansion where it was just me, a shotgun, and a million people with knives. Nick and I, we worked in the same marketing pit and we bonded over, you remember when they sent copies of Mass Effect into space?
No.
Oh my God. And then it crashed into the ocean.
And then there was one out in the Redwood Forest.
Yes.
And someone had to climb up in a tree.
Yes.
And the guy that owned the property almost killed that person. That was Nick.
Okay. Tell us the tree climbing story.
Oh man.
Oh, just the full saga of sending that into space. That is such an amazing move.
Yeah. So... I don't know how like unabashed I'm going to be about my anger with this.
Well, Nick, you've paid for a lot of therapy, and I think you're in a healthy
place
to
talk
about it.
So Mass Effect 3, I don't know if you've heard of it, takes place in a little place called outer space.
Mm, cool.
We thought it'd be really interesting to incorporate maybe like Virgin Galactic in a cool way, or NASA, or some like do some kind of like real life something with this. What the marketing budget allowed for was me spending a couple bucks on a weather balloon and a GoPro to send copies of Mass Effect 3 to space. And I was like, okay, well, like we can make this work. Yeah. Like we'll film it on tape. We'll do like a trailer cut down and be like, Mass Effect 3 is the first game to break the stratosphere. That's a PR stunt.
Yeah, you're just looking for, you want sites to write headlines about, here's some nonsense. Just get Mass Effect in the buzz again.
You remember the wonderful conversation we had about organic followers and building organic interest?
Opposite of that.
This is at the opposite end of the spectrum where things are broken.
Yes.
So we send it to space. And because sending it to space alone isn't enough.
Hey, guys. So it's literally like a finished box copy of Mass Effect 3. Is it just one? Yep. How many did you put up there?
It gets better.
Okay.
So one is on camera, but attached to the weather balloon is a case full of 24 pre-release copies of Mass Effect.
A very story-heavy game. Like, if people get their hands on that early, it's game over.
These were the pre-ship copies, like the ones that come in the box at GameStop that say, do not break street date or you will be tried as a criminal.
But it's also do not turn into a meteor that crashes through your roof.
But it was you were only like 24, 48 hours out anyway.
Yeah. So, we're like, okay, we're going to send it to space. This is going to be really cool. And at the last minute, we're like, well, what if we put GPS on it? And what if we publish the GPS live? And I was like, This is literally the worst idea I've ever heard. Can we not do
going to space? Good.
Yeah.
Having people try to get to space, bad.
Be bad.
Yeah.
So we decide to do it.
like you do.
Go big or go home. So we launched one in San Francisco, Vegas, New York,
London,
and
Paris,
Berlin.
Oh no, they wouldn't let you launch it in Paris.
Yeah. So
I'm trying to remember. Was that like the site of like the first Reaper attacks in 3? Was there any like logic to the cities? London was in one of the trailers, I remember early on.
Originally, again, we were going to fire it into space, and it didn't really matter where we launched it from because space.
Go up.
But then we were like, well, we'll put pre-release copies and publish the GPS so people can voraciously fight over early copies of Mass Effect.
Right.
And we're like, okay, that's insane.
Yeah.
And then we have to do it worldwide because it wouldn't be fair if only people on the West Coast got to fight each other for it.
Right.
It's like,
so you got to find population centers.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So the San Francisco one, we launched two. One, and by the way, weather patterns predicted both would land in, Stockton?
Yeah.
Yeah. Which we're like, okay, that's a drive.
It'll be in a parking lot.
Yeah, Stockton's fine.
I love the intern that has to figure that out. Hey, could you call some sort of weatherman and ask where Mass Effect's going
to
land?
You went to a university.
We were legally required to get that data because the TSA wouldn't let us launch them without showing that our weather balloons were not going to mess up their situation.
Yeah, dude.
So the first one lands in the ocean, as you do.
Whoops.
Yep. Second one lands in the middle of a redwood forest in San Francisco behind private property that has
amazing.
A no trespassing sign.
So put a bookmark in that.
Yeah.
Don't forget that.
The Las Vegas one landed in the middle of a desert somewhere that had no road access.
Death Valley.
Oh, yeah.
The New York one landed in a guy's backyard in Jersey who called the cops on us.
Yep.
I hate Mass Effect.
Yeah. So like...
I'm a coder, man.
I was accountable for the San Francisco launches, and then we sent other people to the other sites. All of North America was like an unmitigated disaster. Like, I felt very validated through my insanity because I called it.
Yes.
But I called the guys in Europe, and I was like, hey, guys, like, we've got to, like, tone this down because this was a total debacle in North America. And I literally cannot give you any advice to survive the next 48 hours of your life.
Right.
They're like, I don't know what you're talking about. We already launched it and everyone already found it. It was fine. We shot it up. It came down. Guys found it. It was great.
Yeah.
Great stunt. Great idea, Nick.
Yay, we did it.
You landed in Germany in like some garden somewhere.
Yeah.
Totally easy to get to. Big like public event. I was just like,
okay.
So
Nick, I heard that a copy landed in the Redwood Forest.
Yeah, you heard correctly. So I'm tracking the weather balloon as it's falling. And I'm driving up the coastline there, like in between Santa Cruz and Half Moon.
There's really good pie out there.
Yeah, we did not get pie on this trip.
Are you seeing like people in cars next to you, like fans racing
along?
Well,
people
are
following me because they know I'm tracking it.
Right.
Oh, and so
Nick told them, like, don't go on private property.
Yeah.
Right. Don't don't be a butthole.
Yeah, and what
come
do
on,
do?
Entire world, don't
yeah,
be a butthole.
Yeah, that works on the internet, by the way.
Yeah,
I wish someone would just say that.
Yeah, so we pull up, we pull up to where we think the like the, basically where the road is like nearest to access this place, and there's like 10 other cars all illegally parked blocking traffic. People are like hopping over this fence that literally says no trespassing, private property.
Yeah.
And we get there and I look up and it, the weather balloon is stuck in like this 200 foot redwood tree. People are starting to climb it with no climbing gear. I have no cell phone reception because I am literally in the middle of nowhere. And I'm like frantically trying to get an arbalist out here before someone dies. And yeah. this goes on for 2 days.
Yeah.
2 days so then, of what?
Of trying to keep people out of the tree.
So I couldn't leave because I had to stop people from climbing the tree, but I couldn't call anyone because my phone was dead.
Right.
And you're just standing by the tree like, back, yeah. back. I don't well, care how much you like, want to see what happens
Reddit,
in Raleigh.
There's Reddit threads where he's like, well, he's got to sleep.
Yeah.
So,
so
someone's like, well, we should bring him food. It's like, no, don't bring him food because he'll have to leave to get food.
Let's and kill him.
Yeah.
So day one concludes. And it's like getting dark and we're literally in the middle of a forest. So there's no lights, no nothing.
Right.
And I'm like, I'm pushing everyone out. Yeah. I write a handwritten letter that like I put on the guy's fence that I'm like, dear Mass Effect 3 fans, we love you. For the love of God, please don't go in here. It's yes. private property. We come back the next day and sure enough, like the guy's waiting. He's like, what are you kids doing? And I was like, nothing. We're leaving. So we write that off. We're like, that balloon is in a tree somewhere never to be seen from or heard from again.
Done.
A week later, someone comes to the EA Redwood Shores office. Like, how they even got the address is whatever.
Eh.
He comes in and he's like, hi, I've got the Mass Effect 3 weather balloon. I didn't know if you guys wanted it back. And I'm like,
what?
No way. And yeah, sure enough, like, yeah. after all of us had written this one off, like, he went back out there, climbed
the
tree.
He went with, like, a cherry picker, like a bucket truck or something.
200 feet?
Yeah.
And a ladder. You put the, I mean... Call your OSHA rep first, but if you put the ladder in the cherry picker, then you can...
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, it was madness.
Yeah. So and anyway...
I have one of the surviving copies that made it to space. Yeah. I mean, it's shattered and beat to hell and back, but...
AAA all day, baby.
It's on my it's on my shelf, and yeah, it's there. It happened.
Was that more or less stressful than the reaction towards the ending to Mass Effect 3, then?
So that's how Nick and I met.
Yeah.
Red alert!
Yeah. I would say... Launching Mass Effect 3 into space was probably one of the most difficult things I have ever had to go through.
Yeah.
Both physically, emotionally, and mentally.
Yeah. But yeah, so
and then the Mass Effect 3 ending happened.
Then that happened and we did that, But that's where Nick and I met at EA. And then you went to Riot.
Yeah.
And then I went and worked on Halo stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's gotta be nice to have League of Legends and Mass Effect on a resume. I imagine that opens a lot of doors for you guys.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. I mean, it opened doors for us to each other.
Yeah.
And that's the only door that matters.
Yeah.
Really.
Yeah, it's like I worked on Mass Effect. I'm like, yep. He's like, I worked on Halo. He's like, yep.
Yeah.
Like, cool.
No, but I mean, I think more than anything, it gave me really good perspective because I'd always come from like the box product world where, like Ian said earlier, you know, you ask someone to spend $60 up front, they play your game, they like it or they don't, they feel slighted by it. And then you end up with the Mass Effect 3 ending scenario all over again.
Yeah.
But a game like League of Legends, it taught me how to operate a live service. It taught me more about free-to-play.
Yeah.
Taught me more about a global market, that's for sure.
Yeah.
I think it's definitely nice to have on the resume. But both were equally different and educational for me, I think, for sure.
Yeah. Well, hey, Dauntless, you guys. If people want to play it, where should they go? How does it work?
Yeah.
Go to space. Where's our redwood forest? Yeah. So you can...
No, you didn't hear. We're going back in time to when dinosaurs roamed, and we're going to put copies there.
Oh, what could go wrong?
Yeah.
Oh. Sound of thunder.
Real quick, is one copy Mass Effect 3 still on the bottom of the ocean?
Yes.
Oh, yeah. We never got the one from the ocean. It's I'm assuming we didn't, because it landed like...
It was out there. There's no way.
Like international.
It's in
waters.
A trench. Yeah. Like it's you're not. I mean, it's probably got crushed.
Like the next James Cameron documentary.
Oh
level.
Yeah.
Yes. Like okay.
Behold, Jacques Cousteau's down there. He just got to the end. He's like, I don't like this. Sorry, man.
Okay, sorry. Dauntless. They want
to. Yeah. You go to playdauntless.com, and we've got trailers. We've got all kinds of good stuff. You can find us on YouTube. You can find us on Twitter. This is a podcast, right?
That's
I can tell you about how if you're looking to make an exciting website for your video game, I highly recommend Squarespace.
we're good. We don't need to.
Yeah, I'll tell you about my Casper mattress and playdauntless.com. We're basically our philosophy is wherever you want to talk about the game, we'll meet you halfway. So we're on Reddit, we're on Twitter, we're on Facebook, we're on We've got our website. Wherever you want, we're on email. Yeah, come in. What is email? You can come in. We don't have Snapchat because I'm not 14, but we'll get there.
Yeah.
But yeah, basically wherever you're comfortable and happy learning about Dauntless, we've tried to set something up for you to do that, and we'd love to have you play and learn more about the game.
We're awesome. We're in closed beta now, but early next year we'll be open, at which point anyone who wants to play can sign up for an account, download the game, jump in, have fun.
Do you guys feel like there's a little bit of an arms race between you and Monster Hunter World to see who gets out there first?
No.
No.
They're gonna do we're gonna do what we're gonna do. I mean, honestly, the biggest impact that Monster Hunter World is going to have on our studio is that we're all going to want to be out for a week playing it. I think we are going to take the time to do that just because we are all such big fans, and we do that for other, like, we took time off for Destiny. We took time off for Mario. I think we're going to probably take some time off for, well, I took time off for Mario, but I think that we'll take some time off.
Mr. 999 stars over here.
Get them all. Wow. Yeah. Well, my dad said he'd take the power glove back if I didn't.
Yeah, his dad just bought a lot of those.
Yeah.
I think more than anything, though, you know, competition's good because I think, you know, it breeds excellence, and a competition builds like the steady tide, right? And I think more than anything, we want to be respectful of people's time. Like, I'm not stupid. I'm not going to like ship our open beta on top of Monster Hunter Worlds because, one, like, that's just silly, and two, it's kind of unfair to players who want to play both games.
Yeah. Yeah.
So I think Monster Hunter Worlds comes out, everyone's gonna have a lot of fun playing it. I know we'll have a lot of fun playing it, and then we'll see how things go, and then we'll probably give players, you know, a little bit of breathing room, and then probably drop some Dauntless stuff near it.
Yeah, sounds good. Hey, Nick and Ian, thank you so much for swinging by.
Thank you for having us.
Time in the podcast.
Really a pleasure. Guys. Thank you.
Absolutely. Yeah. And thank you so much for watching or listening to this episode of the Game Informer Show. Be sure to tune in next Thursday when we have a new episode waiting for you. Bye, everybody.